loneliness is the coat you wear. A deep shade of blue is always there. Place you're in with nothing to lose, but no more to win.
Hey, Donnie Cates.
Ethan, how you doing, pal?
Good. I'm live right now. Like, people can hear you. So I'm warning you of that right now. Like, I'm actually doing a live stream right now. You want to say hi to Comicsgate?
Well, I would prefer if you and I could have a private conversation. I really would.
Well, I can't because I'm having a very public conversation. But if you want to say hi, Comicsgate, they could hear you right now. And they'd be very happy. 2,000 people.
I understand that. We're all good. Everything is good here. I'm just saying that a text. I will. Hey. Look. I'll just say this. Hey, you know what? And I'll just say this. All right. Then. What I will say publicly here.
Right.
I'm serious when I say that. I can see where you're coming from. Okay. I don't know. That's the conversation, right? And look, you're not gonna get this from fucking Scott Snyder. You're not gonna get this from anybody else. Like, I'm actually trying to fucking, like, reach out to you, right? And if I'm not being as eloquent as I want to be right now, I'd like to leave you with this, and but I will say this, man, I will never do anything to try and take food off of anyone's tables.
All right, pal. All right, you have a good one. See you later. Woo!
Between the girls and the jewelry, the devil try and lure me. If you or me, Jesus walks with me. My pastor shaking his head, he ain't sure of me, but surely. Then he asked, do you say your prayers at least 2 a week? I ain't talking to God, I know what I've been doing, G. Do you know how I'd be embarrassed? My prayers sound like Ben Stiller's on Meet the Parents. The good life. But only I could come up with some shit like this. It's say going crazy, and we've seen this before. But I'm doing pretty good as far as geniuses go. And I'm doing pretty hood in my pink polo. Nigga, please, how you gonna say I ain't no low head?
Because of what happened to your mom and dad, that you're telling these lies? You told the worst kind of a lie there is, maybe. The lie of self-deception.
Sorry.
Together they would travel on a boat with billowed sail. Jackie kept the lookout perched on Puff's gigantic tail.
Hey.
Noble kings and princes would bow whenever they came.
I'ma touch the sky.
Pirate ships would lower their flags when Puff roared.
I'm going on an aeroplane.
The magic dragon, oh, live by the sea.
The good life,
and frolicked in the autumn mist, in a land called Halloween.
And now they're making Ghostbusters with only women. What's going on?
George, what happened?
Everyone thinks I'm a white supremacist now.
Oh, George. You either disappear or you join Comicsgate and kind of stand up to these people. And you have a lot of friends if you join Comicsgate.
I would be delighted. I've actually been trying to. I don't know how. I don't have any connections, you know. I'll try to be in touch.
All right, pal.
All right, take care of you, yes.
A few moments later...
You know, look,
I just gotta say this.
Go ahead.
All right, this is gonna sound mean. I really don't like you, but I miss you.
I got honestly.
I'm going to look at anything, John.
Let me at least present my argument, Mike. Okay?
Cut to it.
There it is, right there. You might be seeing things in the clouds, Mike. You know what I mean? Possible.
Sometimes it's just a cloud, Mike.
Sometimes it's just a cloud.
I'm begging you.
Yesterday filed a lawsuit against Preston Poulter for malicious copyright infringement. I've got that here. Welcome to Comic Artist Pro Secrets, everyone. My name is Ethan Van Sciver, world's most charming, disarming, elegant, eloquent, and yet humble man. Great big Sopranos fan and trusted member of the media. What a pleasure it is to be with you guys this evening. We got a lot to do. We got a lot to talk about. Hello. Hi. Let me see here. Hail Rand Nada. Says Jeremy Burtz. Not sure what that is. Peggy, no. Get Peggy, says Man of Action. Let me see. Any plans for a drained version of Wreck Planet in the future, please, says It's Travco. Yeah, I think so. I think we try to do everything the same so that people who are collecting Cyberfrog books in certain formats always have what they're looking for. Josiah Haynes for $5 says, take my money. Yes, thank you. I will. Oh boy, guys, we're getting into this now. We decided to do this. We found many instances of actual trademark infringement, we've decided to jump ahead and take a look at that. Let me show you what we filed. This went in yesterday. I don't know if you guys are interested in this. Are you guys interested in this or not? Do you guys want me to not talk about this? Nick Ricade is going to discuss this in detail. I, of course, am, you know, a layman about this stuff, but if you do want to hear about this, we will. John says, yes, no, yes, yes, 111, yes. Okay, let's take a look at the filing. Here we go. This is an action for malicious use of process, trademark counterfeiting, trademark infringement, and false designation of origin. This is important. Factual background. This is what happened. This is why we are where we are right now. Defendant counterclaim plaintiff Ethan Van Sciver. So this is a part of the lawsuit that he's filed against me. But we are counterclaiming and we are suing him. This whole thing that Preston Poulter has launched against me, it has been a scam from the very start. It's ridiculous. It's insulting. He tried to steal my trademark, which is Comicsgate. I've used it in commerce now since 2018. And the idea that you could just go in there and steal somebody's trademark is outrageous. And we're suing him for it. I'm sick of this. This isn't right. I'm the sole owner of the trademark Comicsgate. He owns U.S. registration number 6102744 for the mark used on comic books. And he owns the right under 15 U.S.C. 1125, the so-called common law trademark, to exclusive use of the mark in connection with services such as crowdfunding of independent comic book projects. Plaintiff counterclaim defendant Preston Poulter, in the name of his company Common Sense Press, applied for two trademark applications for the mark of Comicsgate. Poulter knew, and you guys know this to be true, Poulter knew that the mark Comicsgate was used in commerce by others in the comic book industry before Poulter filed his two trademark applications. He knew that. Of course he did. He left behind a ton of information. He left behind a ton of proof that he knew what he was doing. He actually said it. Number six, specifically, Poulter knew defendant counterclaim plaintiff Van Sciver used the mark Comicsgate in commerce, for example, by hosting the internet YouTube live stream broadcast to promote crowdfunding of certain comic book creators, independent comic book creators. Van Sciver refused to allow Poulter to appear on Van Sciver's live stream, after which Poulter felt animus towards Van Sciver. He felt animus towards me. Why? As a result of this animus, Poulter began a series of YouTube live streams and made statements in social media in which he criticized the Comicsgate group of independent comic book creators and Van Sciver. Poulter has stated, quote, I am working for the destruction of hashtag Comicsgate, quote unquote. Poulter has stated on social media, quote, I've been quite vocal in my opinions about Comicsgate as the hate group. Why would you want to own the trademark of a hate group or something that you felt was a hate group? Poulter has commented on social media about, quote, Ethan Van Sciver is the sociopathic leader of a hate movement and the horrible people who follow him. That's you guys. Horrible. Poulter's animus against Van Sciver greatly increased after a fan a fan. Shout out to Sheila Aliens of the Comicsgate group, discovered and drew attention to several pornographic videos featuring Poulter, which in a previous period of his life, Poulter had placed on the internet. And people know this. People should know that, you know, Preston, I think it's public information. Preston Poulter used to do cuck pornography for sale on Pornhub and I think some other websites he was getting paid for. He did do pegging pornography, and he would ask for 10 bucks or something like that. I don't know how much he charged so that you could see his ex-wife put a dildo in his anus. I didn't ask him to do this. I didn't ask him to do that or put it on the internet. And I certainly didn't ask Sheila Aliens to find it. Sheila was just interested. I mean, you know, this guy was out there making all this content about Comicsgate, criticizing what we do here. And, you know, she, of course, this is who Sheila is. Sheila went out and did a little deep dive search on Preston and found out that, you know, he did make pegging pornography many times. So that's weird. Poulter blamed Van Sciver personally. Blames me. Why does everybody blame me for everything? I didn't do it. Sheila did it for uncovering the uncovering of these pornographic videos and filed. This was the weirdest thing. I forgot about this. Filed at least one police report attempting to have me arrested. He told all his friends that he was having me arrested. He had filed a police report. Can you imagine that police report? Can you imagine the telephone call to the police? Saying, you got to arrest this guy. He found out that I did pegging pornography, or one of his fans did. And then he laughed about it on the internet. Arrest him. He did. He actually filed a police report about this. Then he told everybody that the police did come to my door. They never did. The police never came to my door, but he lied as usual. He just lied. He told everybody that they did. And that was a lie. Claiming somehow the uncovering of Poulter's publicly. So he blamed me personally for uncovering these pornographic videos and filed at least one police report attempting to have Van Sciver arrested, claiming somehow the uncovering of Poulter's publicly available video meant Van Sciver had committed a crime. I didn't know that. I didn't know it was illegal to have, to respond to somebody else who finds your publicly available for sale pornography and laugh at it on the internet. I didn't know that was a crime. The police didn't know either. That's why they didn't come. They didn't come and arrest me. Poulter had produced comic books and other products under the mark Pocket Jacks using the logo shown below. This is his original logo. But after Sheila Aliens humiliated him utterly by revealing his cuck and pegging pornography to the internet, and she did, and it wasn't me, it was Sheila, and in any case, it was public. Anyone could find it. Nobody had to do any deep dive. Nobody had to invade anything. Nobody had to break into anybody's... It was on the internet. It's on the internet. It was under Pornhub. It was everywhere. After Sheila Aliens humiliated Preston Poulter, Poulter altered his logo to infringe on Van Sciver's Comicsgate trademark shown below. As you can see, it now says Comicsgate on this. Okay. Poulter announced that the federal government granted him ownership of the trademark Comicsgate. My lawyer, who was a trademark attorney, points out that Poulter knows that the federal government has not granted him ownership of the trademark Comicsgate. Has not done that. Poulter is now engaged in a massive program of unauthorized commercial use of Van Sciver's trademark, as illustrated by the following 15 infringing products, each of which use the unauthorized... I didn't say he could do this. Quite the contrary. This guy hates Comicsgate and everything it stands for. So I would never give him permission to use the Comicsgate logo on his products, ever. I would never, ever grant him license to use Comicsgate, ever. And yet he's done it anyway. Unauthorized Comicsgate logo from the paragraph above is shown on the following pages. Here we go. One weird comic book, another weird comic book, another weird comic book. All of them say Comicsgate on them. He's selling these on eBay. All of these comics that have my trademark on them, every single one of these Comicsgate, Comicsgate. They all look the same. Why are they all green? Look at all these terrible. Oh, my God. What the hell is this? How many? 15 of these? Oh, what is this? A man in a fucking G-string. Is that a man or a woman? Is that a... What is this? What is this? Palace of the Golden Princess. And I think that's a dude in a G-string there with a sword. What is this? All with my trademark on them. Poulter is using the mark Comicsgate in the following a manner identical to or confusingly similar to the uses authorized by Van Sciver. That is right. All down here. Poulter advertises, promotes, offers to sell, and sells the above products to the public on commercial sites, eBay and Kickstarter, and on information and belief through other commercial channels, such as comic book conventions. He's out there selling my trademark, portraying himself to be Comicsgate. And he's not. I didn't say he was. I did not allow him to use my trademark, Comicsgate, on his frankly awful comic books. I didn't say he could. And the reason why is because, A, he didn't ask me, and B, his comic books are not, and his belief system is not in line with what we all believe. It's not in line with Comicsgate. It's as simple as that. You just have to be Comicsgate. You have to be anti-SJW. You have to stand for, like, you know, all of the things that comic skaters stand for. We all know what they are. This guy does not. He certainly does not. He makes pegging pornography videos for the internet. And he seeks the destruction of Comicsgate. He seeks the destruction of Comicsgate. He said so. And he calls Comicsgate. What did he call him again? I got to go back and find out. But he called you guys some nasty things. Count one, malicious use of process. The allegations in paragraph 3 through 25 are repeated as if set forth fully herein. This is his lawsuit was brought without probable cause. The bringing of the original action is actuated by malice. He admitted it. He admitted it in his stupid Discord server. He said, Ethan's fallen into my trap. Well, what's my trap? What's your trap? I put his trademark on some really skeevy comic books, and he's complained. Now I can sue him for defamation. The bringing of the original action is actuated by malice. The original action will terminate favorably to me, and I've suffered a special grievance, including emotional distress and money costs. This is coming out of my pockets. I have to pay for this lawsuit. This is me and Andrea out of pocket. We work hard. We sell comic books to you guys. We ship comic books to you guys. We don't want to be spending money defending ourselves from, like, frivolous lawsuits. We don't want to be doing that. It's stressful. It's expensive. It's ridiculous. Van Sciver suffered a special grievance, including emotional distress and money costs from defending against this meritless lawsuit. Count two, trademark counterfeiting. The count is for federal trademark counterfeiting under 15 U.S.C. 1114. The allegations in paragraph are repeated, blah, blah, blah. Plaintiff Poulter has used spurious designations that are identical with or substantially indistinguishable from Van Sciver's registered trademark on goods covered by registration for my registered trademark. Poulter has intentionally used these. We can prove it. Spurious designations, knowing they are counterfeit. In connection with the promotion, sale, offering for sale, and distribution of goods. Poulter's use of Van Sciver's registered trademark to promote, offer for sale, distribute, and sell goods bearing counterfeits was and is without the consent of Van Sciver. I did not consent to this. This is non-consensual, unlike his pornography, which was consensual. Poulter's unauthorized use of Van Sciver's registered trademark on and in connection with the promotion, sale, offering for sale, and distribution of products constitutes Poulter's use of the registered trademark in commerce. Poulter's unauthorized use of Van Sciver's registered trademark as set forth is likely to A, cause confusion, mistake, and deception. People are going to see that filth and think it's associated with us. Cause the public to believe that Poulter's products are the same as Van Sciver's products, and or the Poulter's products are authorized, sponsored, or approved by Van Sciver, or that they are affiliated, connected, or associated with, or in some way related to Van Sciver, and C, result in Poulter unfairly benefiting from my advertising, which is what he wanted to do in the first place, isn't it? Isn't that what he wanted to do in the first place? Isn't that why there is this problem right here? He wanted to benefit from my advertising, and he wasn't able to. Profiting from the good reputation of Ethan Van Sciver and my registered trademark, all to the substantial and irreparable injury of the public, that's you guys, Van Sciver, anybody who buys his book, and Van Sciver registered trademark, and the substantial goodwill, that's you guys. You guys have goodwill towards Comicsgate, obviously. You love Comicsgate. If there was a book that said Comicsgate on it, you'd be more likely to pick it up and look at it because you're Comicsgate. That's the problem here. You'd go, oh, this must be something that Ethan Van Sciver thinks is okay. I don't think this is okay. This is fraud. Poulter's acts constitute willful trademark counterfeiting in violation of Section 32 of the Lanham Act, 15 U.S.C. 1114. By the reason foregoing, get ready for this, Poulter is liable to Van Sciver for statutory damages in the amount of $200,000 for each counterfeit mark per type of goods sold, offered for sale, or distributed. Or if the court finds that the use of the counterfeit mark was willful, and it was, obviously, it is clear that it was willful. He knew what he was doing. He bragged about it all over the fucking internet on Bleeding Cool, on that cuckold Forced Adversities channel. He knew what he was doing. He knew it. He admitted it. He talked about it. $200,000 for each counterfeit mark per type of goods sold, offered for sale, as provided by 15 U.S.C. 1117 of the Lanham Act, or at Van Sciver's election at any time before final judgment is rendered by the court trial pursuant to 15 U.S.C. 1117, and unless the court finds extenuated circumstances, a mandatory award to Van Sciver of judgment for three times such profits or damages, whatever amount is greater, together with the reasonable attorney's fees, investigative fees, and pre-judgment interest. This court, this is a count three, trademark infringement. This is worse than trademark violation. This count is for federal trademark infringement. Poulter's activities constitute Poulter's use in commerce of Van Sciver's registered trademark. Eric Winberg says, next CG deep dive needs to star Cecil. Poulter uses Van Sciver's registered trademark in connection with Poulter's sale, offers of sale, distribution, promotion of Poulter's goods bearing infringements and or counterfeits of Van Sciver's registered trademark. Let me see. ETAI Coleco Critter says, beckon your space surfing Harold John Malone. John Malone, where are you? Come on in here if you're watching. No, they have the link. I put the link in Comicsgate King, so if anybody wants to join, they can. But again, it's Christmas. Poulter has used Van Sciver's registered trademark knowing it is the exclusive property of Van Sciver in connection with Poulter's sale. We can prove all this. Preston left behind a slug trail of admissions, of plans. It's pretty easy to follow. It's pretty easy to understand. Distribution and promotion of Poulter's goods bearing counterfeits or infringements of Van Sciver's registered trademark. Poulter's activities create the false and misleading impression that Poulter is sanctioned, assigned, or authorized by me to use my registered trademark to advertise, manufacture, distribute, appraise, offer for sale, or sell goods bearing my registered trademark when Poulter is not so authorized. I didn't say yes to this. Anonymity T2 says, will you be joining Rackets tonight? I don't think so. He told me he's going to be going through this. That's cool. I want him to go through it. He doesn't need me there. Poulter engages in the aforementioned activity with the intent
He means to do this. Again, he said all of this. He said it in the Bleeding Cool article. He said it many times. His intent is to confuse and deceive the public into believing that he and the goods he sells are in some way sponsored, affiliated, or associated with Van Sciver, when in fact there's no business relationship between me and Preston Poulter. Of course not. Poulter's use of my registered trademark has been without the consent, without my consent. It's likely to cause confusion, mistake the minds in the minds of the public, and in particular tends and does falsely create the impression that the goods promoted, distributed, and sold by Poulter are authorized, sponsored, warranted, approved by me, when in fact they're not. Poulter's unauthorized use of Van Sciver's registered trademark has resulted in Poulter unfairly benefiting from my advertising and promotion, because I talk about ComicsGate all day long, and he's got my trademark on his book. So people go, oh, is this something that Ethan, is this Ethan's thing? No. It is not. It is not. Pih. Profiting from the reputation of Van Sciver's registered trademark to the substantial and irreparable injury of the public, because anybody who buys his comics thinking it's ComicsGate and it stands for what we stand for, that I approve of it, the quality that I insist upon, they are going to be injured by that. Anonymity2T says you should go for the audience. Perfect chance to grift the comics and toys. Go for the audience. Oh, you mean on Nick's show? Well, I was not invited to be on Nick's show, you know, so it doesn't matter. I didn't say, hey, what about me? Bring me on. Michael Bancroft says, wait, the dude in the thong wasn't your book? No, was not my book. It's not what ComicsGate stands for. Poulter's acts constitute willful trademark infringement in violation of Section 32 of the Lanham Act. By reason of the foregoing, Poulter is liable to Van Sciver for the amount representing three times Van Sciver's damage and or Poulter's illicit profits, reasonable attorney's fees, investigative fees, and prejudgment interest. This count three, false designation of origin. This is count for false designation of origin in violation of Van Sciver's trademark rights. Poulter's use in commerce, et cetera, not approved by me. In view of the acts described above, Poulter's use constitutes a false designation of origin, false or misleading description of fact, or a false or misleading representation of fact. Van Sciver believes he is or is likely to be damaged by Poulter's acts, of course. That was the intention. And as a result, Poulter is liable to Van Sciver under 15 U.S.C. There you go. It's infuriating. Prayer for relief. Wherefore, defendant counterclaim plaintiff Van Sciver requests the court order the following relief: that the court enter an injunction ordering the plaintiff Poulter, the defendant Poulter, in this case, his company and any persons in privity or acting in concert with them to be enjoined from A, using in reproduction, counterfeit, copy, or colorable imitation of Van Sciver's registered trademark to identify any goods, can't use it, or the rendering of any services not authorized by me. B, engaging in any course of conduct likely to cause confusion, deception, or mistake, or injure Van Sciver's business or reputation, or weaken the distinctive quality of Van Sciver's registered trademark, Van Sciver's name, reputation, or goodwill. C, using a false description or representation using words or other symbols tending to falsely describe or represent Poulter's unauthorized goods as being those of mine or sponsored by or associated with me and from offering any such goods in commerce. D, further infringing on Van Sciver's registered trademark by manufacturing or producing, distributing, circulating, selling, marketing, or offering for sale, advertising, promoting, displaying, or otherwise disposing of any products not authorized by me, bearing any simulation, reproduction, counterfeit copy, colorable imitation of my registered trademark. Using any simulation, reproduction, counterfeit copy, or colorable imitation of my registered trademark in connection with the promotion, advertisement, display, sale, offering for sale, manufacture, production, circulation, or distribution of any unauthorized projects in such fashion as to relate or connect or tend to relate or connect such products to any in any way to me, any goods sold, manufactured, sponsored, or approved by, or connected with me. Stop making statements or representation whatsoever using false designation of origin, false description, performing any act which can or is likely to lead the trade or public or individual members thereof to believe that any services provided, products manufactured, distributed, sold, or offered for sale, or rented by Poulter are in any way associated with or connected with me and my trademark. I did not approve, did not sponsor, did not license, did not manufacture or authorize this. Or G, engaging in any conduct constituting an infringement of Vanskyver's registered trademark or Vanskyver's rights in or to use or to exploit said trademark or constituting any weakening of Vanskyver's name, reputation, or goodwill. Hello, hello, chat. Welcome. Take a break, take a drink. 939 people, 979 people watching right now. Thank you. Please hit that thumbs up button. God bless you all. Yeah, this is publicly available. You're free to read this. You can find it. You can read it. Secreting, destroying, altering, removing, or otherwise dealing with the unauthorized product which contain any information relating to the importing, manufacturing, producing, distributing, circulating, selling, marketing, offering for sale, advertising, promoting, or displaying of all unauthorized products which infringe on my trademark. Affecting assignments or transfers, forming new entities or associations, or utilizing any device for the purpose of circumventing or otherwise avoiding the prohibition set forth in subparagraphs A through H. That Poulter, within 10 days of judgment, take all steps necessary to remove from all business owned, operated, or controlled by Poulter all texts or other media offering for sale any merchandise bearing the infringement or counterfeits of Vanskyver's registered trademark or mark substantially indistinguishable therefrom. That Poulter, within 30 days of judgment, file and serve Vanskyver with a sworn statement setting forth in detail the manner and form in which he has complied with this injunction pursuant to 15 U.S.C. 1116A. The Poulter be required to deliver up for destruction to Vanskyver all unauthorized materials bearing any of Vanskyver's registered trademark in association with unauthorized goods or services and the means for production of same pursuant to 15 U.S.C. 1118. Hold on a second here. Cars and Dev says, still no sketch card. When should I start worrying? It's on its way. Don't worry. Do not worry about this. Comics Bear says, subparagraphs A through H. We shall build a mighty pyre, says Bancroft. Yes! Number five, requiring Poulter to pay Vanskyver such damages Vanskyver has sustained. They're infinite damages as a consequence of Poulter's counterfeiting and infringement of Vanskyver's registered trademark. Every SJW in the world thinks that Poulter, because of his lies, because of his actions, he goes to these shows. They think he's associated with Comicsgate. He isn't. Comicsgate is mine. It's my trademark. Manic Boy Productions says, just a little funds to help stop this pervert. F this guy. Thank you, Manic Boy Productions. Appreciate $20. This guy is not associated with my trademark, my registered trademark. To account for all gains, profits, and advantages derived by Poulter from the sale of his infringing merchandise bearing Vanskyver's registered trademark, and that the award to Vanskyver be trebled as provided for under 15 U.S.C. 1117. Alternatively, that Vanskyver be awarded statutory damages pursuant to 15 U.S.C. up to $2 million for each mark per type of goods sold or offered for sale the Poulter has willfully counterfeited and infringed. $2 million. Ordering that Vanskyver recover the cost of this action together with reasonable attorney's fees, prejudgment, and interest in accordance with 15 U.S.C. Yeah, give me my money back for this. Ridiculous. Ordering that Vanskyver recover attorney's fees due to plaintiff's malicious use of prosecution, which we can prove it was. He bragged about it. This is all just a series of lies. This whole thing was a one big gay op. directing that this court retain jurisdiction for this action for the purpose of enabling Vanscarver to apply to the court at any time for such further orders and interpretations or execution of any order entered in this action, for the modification of any such order, for the enforcement or compliance therewith, and for the punishment of any violations thereof. Ordering that pursuant to 11 U.S.C., Poulter be prohibited from a discharge under this 11 U.S.C. 727 for malicious, willful, and fraudulent injury to Vanscarver. Awarding to Vanscarver such other and further relief as the court may deem just and proper, together with the costs and disbursements that Vanscarver has incurred in connection with his action, which are significant, which are very significant. I want you to know. Ridiculous. There you go. There's my lawyer. One of my lawyers. There you go. There's another one of my lawyers. Beautiful. So that's that was filed today. And yeah. We're going after this, dude. Crypto Ken says, read faster. I read as fast as I could. And I think Nick Mercado will go through it and maybe he'll talk about it a little bit. Maybe, you know, obviously, I'm not a lawyer. I'm just reading it. I'm a lay person. I'm the injured party. These people just try to bother me. They try to hurt me. They try to hurt you and respect to the same cause. Trying to destroy Comicsgate. For what reason? For what reason? Casis says, Ethan, why can't you put a tie on for us? I thought about it, but I decided not to. Sheila Allen says, when is Nick covering this? Tonight. Tonight, he says. I don't know when that is. Yeah. All this nonsense because CG rules. Yeah. The more I think about it, the more I realize how important Comicsgate is, the more I realize how important it is that I protect the trademark. I do that because otherwise you've got bad actors here. It is political. They just want to destroy it. He just wants to destroy it. He wants to slime us. He wants to slime me. He's doing all of this intentionally and with malice. He brags about it. He talks about it. I don't know if he's drunk when he posts all this stuff, but like he posts all this stuff. It's all provable. It's not a matter of opinion. We can actually prove all of this with his own words. It's insane. It is absolutely insane. Nick is covering it right now. Oh, let's go take a look at Nick then. Why wouldn't we do that? Why wouldn't we? Is Nick on? Wait a second. Where is Nick? Let me see. Are you going to be on when Nick covers it, or is he doing it solo? I think he's doing it solo. Pretty sure. Is Nick on YouTube, or is he somewhere else? Ethan is going to show Zach how to follow through on a court case. Yes, I will. Okay. I will follow through on this. I think it's important that I do. Ridiculous. I didn't start this. He did. I didn't ask for this. I didn't ask for this bullshit. He did. He started this. For what? Just to fuck with me. That's all it is. All right. So what can you guys do to help? I'm glad you asked. Back, Second Chance, CyberFrog 2, Wreck Planet, right here. We are closing this down on Sunday. We will be fulfilling this comic book in just a matter of days. We will begin fulfilling CyberFrog 2, Wreck Planet. Very excited about that. We are completely paying for this lawsuit our damn selves at this point. It is very pricey. But Andrea reminded me that, like, we're in this for a reason. It's not just about making money, although we hope to. We hope that, you know, we'll profit from what we're doing eventually. But Comicsgate means a lot more to us than short-term gains. If we suffer for this, we suffer for this. That's it. At the end of the day, we're going to win because we're right. And, you know, I think it's worth fighting for. So anyway, that's what's going on. And then Andino Palacio says, Ethan's asking for a handout. Yes. Can you spare a dime? Let me see here. If you're touching cloth, there's only one option. Follow through, E. Says Sarangus Fungus. Thank you. I will. Rick says, big ups, EVS. Thank you, guys. But this is insane. This whole thing that he's launched against me is insane. It doesn't make any sense. I don't know why he would do it. It's purely for malice. And that's it. That's all it is. It is a very strange obsession that this individual has with me. Very strange. And he actually said that it's because he's mad at his father. Dude, I am not old enough to be your father. If I remind you of your dad, get some fucking help. Like, I am not old enough for that. I don't know how old Preston is, but my friend, just because my beard is gray, I'm your age. What are you talking about? Absolutely insane. All right, so there's that. What else is going on? Oh, I wanted to show you guys this wonderful, wonderful work for Rainbow the Brute. This is... we bought a story from Bill Willingham. This was illustrated by Chad Townsend, who's in the chat all the time, and colored by Jason Wright. And it really is extraordinary. Wait a second. Let me get that. Okay. It really is beautiful. Look at the colors on this. Look at the artwork. So this was like the first script that I ever purchased from Bill Willingham. Quite happy to do it. Very proud of myself for this. And the colors are great. How come I can't skip ahead? Exit full screen. Let me see. Go back one. How do you do this? Everything's a nightmare. Okay, I guess that's it. Yeah, it's not. Let me show you another page, if possible. And Proby says, you make me proud, Ethan. Thank you for $15. I appreciate that. Oh, now look at this artwork. Look at this. This looks great. Why is it frozen? I can't zoom in. Let me try this. What if I did this? No, that didn't work. It certainly didn't work. Zoom in. I'm annoyed. The zoom isn't working. All right. I'm just going to say, fuck that. And go about. Trust me, it's a great looking book, great looking story there that gets added to Cool Story, bro. And I'm excited about you. It's not me. You're calling me a boomer. It's not me. There's some kind of malfunction happening there. Diversity and Dragon says, PP begged to be on your channel ad nauseum. Yeah, again, I mean, look, if Comicsgate were a hate group, it's certainly a hate group that he begged to be a part of, was desperate to be associated with. Obviously, it's not a hate group. Obviously, it is something of value, something that I think, in my opinion, he's trying to steal. And I don't think that's appropriate, obviously. That's why we are suing him. Him trying to trademark CG was what made me look into who he is, says Sheila. Wow. Good job, Sheila. Great job. All right, I'm just going to talk to you guys now and see how you're doing. If you have any questions for me. Loose nut behind the keyboard says brains taste awful. Maybe that's what it is. Let me try again, just in private. Let me see if I can fix it. No, I'm just going to close it out. Annoying. And it looked really good. I was very excited about showing you. Play the bagpipe, says Sheeple Hunter. Do I look Scottish today? Do I look like a Scotsman? Awesome. Spike and Mattis says, you called down the thunder. No, now you got it. Yeah. Hey, listen, we just want to do our thing. Yeah, we just want to do our comics and our live streams. Comics Bear is here. Greetings, EVS. Hello, Comics Bear. Enjoy your channel. People should subscribe to the Comics Bear. He's a comic skater. Yeah. Let me see here. Your suits always bunch up at the top. Yeah, I know. Andrea says that too. She's like, whenever you're sitting down, you hunch over and then your suit bunches up. Same thing happened to JFK in the back of his limousine, Sheila. That's why the bullet hole looks like it's in a different place in his jacket to where it hit him anatomically, because he was leaned forward like this and his jacket hunched up. And so people still puzzle over that. They go, why don't the holes make sense in JFK's wounds and in his clothing? That's why. That's just the phenomenon there. Am I the only one who likes Shane's new theme song, says Kay Sis. I haven't heard it. I haven't heard Shane's new theme song. Let me see. Babbling Booby says, you make a half-decent Peaky Blinder. EVS looks like Bill Murray's boss in Caddyshack. What's Graham Nolan up to? Oh, Graham Nolan was on Gary and Az today. I did see that. I was like, yeah, I see you guys. But no, I think he did good. I think he made like a good $6,000 on Ghost of Matacumba Key, which was good. I don't think he got to six figures yet. Let me check that. Maybe he did like in the kind of aftermath of being on that show. The show was obviously a very profitable thing. I was hoping to be able to, I was in the chat cheering him on, I think much to the disgust of those guys. Like, yes, promote my friend. That's all I ask. I just want you guys to actually promote indie comics. Ghost of Matacumba Key, very close to six figures now. And I think this is a $10,000 day for our guy, Graham Nolan. So this is great. If you haven't backed Ghost of Matacumba Key. Florida hurricane spreads death in its wake. You shadow banned everyone, so please put the link in the chat. Oh, I didn't know what you meant about Shane's new team. I want to F you in the A. Yes, everyone, back. Graham Nolan's. Oh, did I read the penalties wrong on my Preston Poulter filing? I'm being told you said it was like 200,000. It's 2 million. Hold on a second. I don't know. I'm not sure here. I might have just like misspoken. Ghost of Matacumba Key. Yeah, it's disgusting, dude. This is absolutely infuriating. Why do I have to put up with this? Why am I so special that I have to put up with this? Just nonsense. Leave me alone. Go do your own shit. Leave me alone. Go away. Leave me alone. Stop bothering me. Leave me alone. Why bring it to my attention what you're doing? I don't care. Look at this. I don't care about this. This stuff is shit. Go so mad up. Kumba Key. It is. Oh, yeah, $200,000 for each counterfeit mark, but $2 million for each counterfeit mark if the court finds that it was willful. And it was willful, dude. Sorry, $2 million. He knew what he was doing. He even said it, dude. He said, that pisses me off. I thought I read 2 million there, but I might have just misspoken. Ghost of Matacumba Key. So we're involved in a lawsuit, guys. We're suing. We're counter-suing. Godspeed, Ethan. Comic Skate Shall Prevail. Thank you, Robert Romano. I appreciate you. And thank you for bringing those eBay auctions to my attention. I didn't realize that that's what was going on. Ricade is talking about the lawsuit tonight, says Nathan Pohl. Yes. Let me see here. Danny Grimm says, when do we start making fun of one-legged Smiller? I was really enjoying the back and forth with Smiller tonight. I really was. I thought that was fun. I love making fun of Smiller. I love it because even though it seems like he's enjoying it himself, he isn't. He cannot take a joke. You know, he can dish it out, but he can't take it. Sarubasen says, you're a threat like Gina Carano to the monsters. So, I guess so. Is Gina Carano a threat to monsters? P. Cowan says, pull the back of your shirt down. Yeah, that's what I just did. I pulled it down. And I keep having to do that because you know what I should do is sit on it. Like, what if I sit on the back of my coat? Is that going to work? I don't know. He was wearing a back brace, says Kefka fanatic. Yeah, that's why he couldn't fall down when he got the first gunshot. He sat up straight for the headshot. People are saying, no, it was a magic bullet. I've been watching a bunch of conspiracy shows about this and just enjoying them. I mean, I really, really do enjoy the craziness. I wish it was true. I watched Everything is a Rich Man's Trick. That was recommended. Boy, that was great. All lies. And by the way, in the comments section, people are like, you watch this and you realize how evil the government is. And it's like, yeah, if any of this was true, I guess. If any of this was true, I guess you would be like, okay, thank you. Don Edwards is saying that was $2 million, not $200,000. Go back to that. Read it again. You're right. Sorry about that. $2 million, if intentional and willful. Let me see. EVS, how are the Cyberfrog Rec Planet Chromium comics and Blacklight posters coming along at the printers? I did get an update. The Blacklight posters, I haven't heard anything about yet. The paper has been ordered. I do know that. So the poster paper has been ordered and paid for, and they are beginning production on that. I don't have anything to tell you about that yet. Cyberfrog Rec Planet Chromium covers suffered a little bit of a setback today in quality control. And I will read to you what I received. And it was annoying as fuck because I really want these. Like, I want them. You know what I mean? Like, I just want them in my hands. But let me see here. Ethan, we were conducting our quality control process and discovered a potential issue in a few books. There was some cracking on the spine due to the heavy text block. What does that mean? Putting pressure on the score of the plastic slash cover. They are testing a different scoring method today. I just got this today, 9 hours ago. And tomorrow, to see if that rectifies the issue, we're pretty confident that it will. While it is not a widespread problem, we certainly do not want anyone having an issue with the books cracking. That sounds horrible, dude. The book cracking. Once I hear results about the new scoring test, we will update you. Okay, so I just heard that today, and that sounds like a 1 or 2 day delay, but, you know, at least it's coming along. Let me see here. That music is so hypnotic, says Sir Angus Fungus. Chat says $2 million. Yes, $2 million. Let me see. Biggins has been working behind the scenes. On what, Biggins? What are you doing behind the scenes? Opinionated News Guy says, when do you expect to start fulfilling Rec Planet? I expect to begin this month, okay? And I, as soon as I get them, it's outside of my control. You got to understand, like, I've done everything that I can possibly do, and now it's up to everybody else to sort of finish printing the books and send them to me, at which time I will send them out, like, immediately. I will be on it. I am anxious to do it, but it's like something like that is not within my control. All I can do is go, okay, thanks for the update. Let me see. Hail chat, hail EVS, got my holiday card in the mail. Good. I hope you guys are getting your holiday cards. If you're channel members, if you've joined the channel, you are supposed to receive this year's exclusive trading card right here. This is the holiday trading card. We do one every year. We did one last year. We're going to do one next year. So it's going to be an annual thing. 2002 holiday card. Merry Christmas and happy holidays from your friends at All Caps Comics. People are receiving these. We did send out, I think, something like 600 or 700 of these already. But if you haven't received one yet because, you know, you didn't give us your address, now is a good time to do that. Just or if you haven't joined the channel yet, join the channel. And then you will find in the community tab of section where you can insert, you can, you know, put your address in there. We will send you out your trading card. The other way to get one is to buy one, buy something on our eBay store, anything. We're throwing in the holiday card for free with every single order while supplies last. So you can determine how you want to do that. Opinionated News Guys. Oh, I read that one already. Okay, hold on. Let me fast forward here. Sir Ubisan, what Marvel hero can Cyberfrog best in a VG style fight? What's VG style? What is that VG? In a VG style fight, he can beat most of them. Okay. If he's connected to Chelsin, if Cyberfrog is connected to Chelsin, he could beat the Hulk. Like Cyberfrog could beat anybody as long as he's connected to Chelsin to adapt, to rapid evolve to any situation. On his own, he could tangle with Spider-Man. Without Chelsin, he could tangle with Spider-Man. But yeah, he's much, much stronger. He's got the potential. He's unlimited power, you know, locked into his body there. All right, let me see here. You're special because of that extra chromosome, says G1 Gavox. Thanks. Appreciate that. Sheila Alien says, your enemies are embarrassing, nor formidable. Patrick T says, EVS is carrying the weight of the world. Oh, is that what this is? I mean, is this the weight of the world? Just walking around yesterday and being like, you know, walking around the concert, standing up the entire time at the concert, all of that was, I woke up a little bit stiff, a little bit sore. And I said to myself, at least today, I'm going to only eat clean. I'm going to eat clean foods. I'm just going to eat things that are, you know, like I used to when I was dieting. I would only eat clean foods that weren't prepared. They had to be as simple as possible. And the way to eat clean is basically to do the outside of the supermarket. When you go shopping, you go through produce, you go through the butchers. You do not go up and down the aisles. That's where all the filth, the garbage is. And you just eat as clean as possible. You cook a steak, you cook some chicken. You know, you eat a lot of fruit and vegetables. I had some carrots today. I ate some pineapple. I ate a beautiful roast chicken. And I feel better. I mean, that was good. But yeah, I got to stop eating garbage. I don't want to eat any junk anymore. It doesn't make me feel good. And really, it's not about how you look. It is. But it's really how you feel. I want to wake up every morning happy and enthusiastic to start my day. So let me see. Mr. Biggin says, Smiller got no chill. Yeah, Mike S. Miller is on Twitter right now, engaged in some typical bullshit. You can go take a look at that on my Twitter if you want to. Yakase says, because you created something of value and they can't stand it, that's why you're dealing with it. Plus, the good Lord knows you're strong enough to handle it. Help me, God. Help me, Comicsgate. I love you guys. Thank you. Manic Boy Production says, don't understand why the FNT guys don't get over it. Can't they take a joke or roast or two? I think I understand it. I don't care, man. I wish them the best of luck doing what they're doing, which has nothing to do with what I'm doing. Nothing to do with what I'm doing. They're doing something else. I'm doing my own thing here, and the two things really, it's disappointing sometimes, but they can actually be of assistance and help to comic skaters if they choose to do that. And when they do that, in the instances where they help Eric July, in the instances where they help Graham Nolan, in the instances where they help Shadiversity or any other creator who wants to do independent comics, they are assisting my cause, and that's all I want. It doesn't have to be me. You don't have to support me, guys, if you just, you know, but when you're supporting independent comics, you're making the world a better place. And that's all I ask. So them doing that for Graham Nolan today, it was very serious when I was in their chat. I said, thank you. Thank you for that. Appreciate it. Let me see here. Scrolling down. Yeah, civil action against DVS for cracked comics. Yeah, I know what they're talking about. I know that, like, if you fold the if you fold a chromium cover a certain way, this weird kind of cracking appears at the fold. And this was a problem last time too. But there's a certain way to, there's a certain machine that you can use to crease that cover once. It's basically why you can't do a chromium comic that has a spine, because then you have to fold it twice and then cracking is almost certainly going to occur. But it, there's a certain machine that worked when we did Blood Honey, and it worked fine and there was no cracking, but the first round of them did have cracking. So, you know, I understand this. I get it. Patience is a virtue, says Monster01. I try to recall that. I try to remember that. John Porton says, I believe in you, Uncle Lee. You know what it feels like? It's just it being this waiting for something that I'm really anticipating is tough. I wake up every day like, is this the day that I'm going to find Wreck Planet on my doorstep? No, this is not the day. Maybe tomorrow. Maybe the next day. Well, tomorrow I'm hoping to hear that the experiment went fine and the new, they were able to crease the comics without cracking. Neon Knight Rider says that inside sketch cover ruining these books. Inside sketch cover, you think so? I don't think so. I don't think that has much to do with it, Neon Knight Rider. I'm not sure about that. Let me see here. Cyberfrog fighting game. When? Dude, soon. I mean, again, if you go to amphibionics.com, that is the website that is all Cyberfrog all day long, run by EJ Morges. You can download 3D Robin's wonderful Cyberfrog fighting game sampler, and it really is good. And there's a secret game, a mini game in there. You go into this one room, and there's an arcade, and Cyberfrog will play Pie Man, and it's me as Pac-Man with a big nose, like eating pies, and the ghosts are my family that are chasing me around, like Hunter, Ava, and Andrea trying to kill me, which is interesting. Trevor Wright says, any updates on action figures? I plan on buying a few more on BBTS so they keep supporting Comicsgate creators. No updates on action figures to date. We sent back our Heather Swain action figures, our complaints about them. And we are waiting to see repairs. As you can see, like, Heather looks cool, but her hinge, for example, is still blue in there, in her pants. Things like that, and a multiple series of issues like that. So the action figures campaign is still up there, and you can still back the action figure campaign. I appreciate it. Let me see. Scrolling down. VG is video game. Vidya game, says Pablo Diablo. Oh, I guess so. Yeah, I think Cyberfrog would do really well in the video game matchup, like a Mortal Kombat style video game against Marvel characters. Marvel characters aren't really that strong, most of them. They're not DC characters. Like DC characters, Green Lantern, Superman, you know, it's like Wonder Woman would probably beat up Cyberfrog, but Marvel characters are, wake up angry, EVS. Wake up mad. Now, let me see. Opinionated News Guy says the bakery is on the perimeter of the supermarket. That is true. Skip the bakery as much as possible. Skip that. You really just want to choose clean foods. You want to choose foods that are not processed. And of course, baked goods are processed. So don't eat those. Pies are in the perimeter of the grocery store. Yeah, Danger Vanessa, you're exactly right. But I skipped those. Don't worry. I understand. Cumberbatch Pepper Pot says, keep the change, of filthy animals. Thank you for $10. Appreciate you. Let me see. TC says, Ethan, don't talk shit about them and they'll be supportive. They're basically fans. They serve the fans. Yeah, okay. Well, what did I just do? I just said nice things about them. What do you want? I don't know what else I'm supposed to do. Cumberbatch Pepper Pod says, Ethan has plumber's crack sometimes, yeah. I appreciated that they helped Graham today, but they could have also said hello to you in chat, says Joshua45. Yeah, they could have. But it's like stuff like that becomes clear, you know. It's like I would have said hello to them, sure. TC says, Ethan, stop being a dick to people and your life will get better. My life is pretty darn good, TC. I don't think I'm being a dick to anyone who's not being a dick to me. And I think that's true. I think people are being a dick to me. And then I answer their energy in kind. Most of the time, I ignore that. If I was a dick to everyone who was a dick to me, I'd be very busy. I can't do that. I just don't have the energy for that. But sometimes I do respond, and sometimes I do point out that people are behaving like penises, and I do have to make that clear. I'm not saying that Friday Night Tights are behaving like penises. I'm just saying in general. Let me see. Hero Guy says, CG should focus on making more comics instead of Twitter drama. Point out to me what you mean. What are you referring to? What are you referring to then? Let me get caught up with you guys here. Toki Deathhammer says, Ethan, just be fat. It's your destiny. Maybe. I don't know. I don't think it's anyone's destiny to be fat. Not mine. I mean, I could be skinny. I've been skinny most of my life. Well, I guess that's not true, is it? I was skinny all through my, up to about 25. So about half of my life I've been skinny, and the other half I was fat. Master Boob says, somebody make me a Cyberfrog game for Nintendo 64. I would love to see that. What is this? Faz Mazinan says, I got slammed on Rudy Giuliani's channel. They didn't like the crack. Nice to see Rudy stop using shoe polish to dye his hair. Had no idea he was so sensitive. Well, if he's using shoe polish to dye his hair, he's probably sensitive about something. After all, I'm very sensitive about my beard and my beard dye. I come in with my, like right now it's gray with nice patches of brown in it. Why is this still so dark? Like all the way to, that's weird that this is dark at the roots still. I don't understand why that's happening. But then I'll come in with a completely black and my head shaved and I try to pretend like nothing's different. Clearly, I'm very sensitive. Like, clearly, I'm very shallow and vain. And I don't want everybody to make fun of my beard. I'm not trying to draw attention to myself, to sudden changes in my appearance. And if you did, I'd probably be very upset. The chat would probably, if you said, Ethan, nice dyed beard, you weirdo. Surely I would be like, and the chat would probably turn on you. My chat would be very loyal to me, and they would probably turn on you. My chat would not join in. They would not join in on you, with you, on making fun of me. They'd probably be like, you know what? Why don't you leave Ethan alone? They would say, first of all, I think he looks good. Second of all, don't you think he has feelings? Don't you think Ethan has feelings? Patrick T says, doubtful. Hold on. We need pink or blue beard for the next SJW stream. Who am I? Doug Tenaple? I'm not doing that. I'm not a clown. I mean, I'm a clown, but not a clown. Ray says, does the carpet match the drapes? I think you're assuming there is a carpet. Let me go ahead. Oh, I shouldn't have said that. Oh, that's disturbing. You want to stay clean, though. Snarkticon DM says, go hairless, like the Matt Damon puppy play guy from the Department of Energy. I don't know what you're referring to. Ethan is a national treasure, says Johnny B. Good. Thank you so much. I appreciate that. The chat is only just now responding to that. Yurashima Taru says, stop trying to get E to make up with Friday Night Tights. It's gay. Look, I already tried. I already did. I gave it my best. I sent fruit baskets. A basket of fruit to everyone. Ethan Van Brazilian. I just threw up in my mouth a little. Well, what do you want? You ask questions. You say too much information, but you ask for the information. Mike Kelly is saying, when's Rec Planet's second chance ending? Sunday night. We're going to close it down Sunday night. It is important that we do that. We've got to close it down. Because we're running out of books. The whole thing is, I would leave it open forever, but I already put in the print run. There's a certain amount of books that are coming, and we're selling out of them. Zedek Kovstadon says, pull up Alex Stein's video of him, Cecil, and a homeless guy getting thrown out of Barstool headquarters. All right, I did see that. Now, my whole thing was, I didn't know why that was happening. I didn't know why that was going on. Hold on a second. You know what? While I'm doing this, okay, I got to do something else. Share screen. I can have a conversation with you and simultaneously get this done here. All right, so we got this. Let me speed it up all the way. Play speed times two. And then I got to also silence this. Okay. So now I can have a conversation with you while this is running and going on the record. Now, a lot of people were very upset that they didn't get to see me draw this year's Under Panta Claus because it was blocked. It was blocked because of some musical something or other that got through. And, of course, that is a depressing outrage because we did spend a long time drawing it, and a lot of people woke up to see the final result but didn't get to actually see it get done. So what I'm doing here is I'm playing it. Now, it's blocked to you, but it's not blocked to me. I can still see the video. I can still show the video. And if I mute the volume, then I can, and I play it at fast speed, then we can enter it onto the record. You'll still be able to see me draw. Opinionated News Guy says, what extras do I get with the 4-book folder tier and a separate order of Death Sting? These are good questions. So with the 4-book folder, you will also receive Kelsey Shannon's 2 covers, one of which is Kelsey Shannon's Death Sting variant and also Kelsey Shannon's American Hopper variant. That makes 6 books. And then you will also receive Heartsick Horror, and you will receive the Deleted Scenes book. Then you will receive the mail-in card, censored page card reproduction. So that's what you're going to receive with the, it's 8 books in all, 8 books total. It is the best deal. Without question, it is the best deal. And thank you. And thank you for backing the campaign. I appreciate it. Wandering Comics Gate King, Marduk Knight, my friend who knows and is working with. Dude, you are doing work for Dojar Cat. I mean, I can't believe how cool you are. Wandering Comics Gate Kings, like I said, King, Marduk Knight, is a superstar. You don't know who he is. He prefers to stay anonymous, but he's actually doing work, commercial work for Dojar Cat. You know, he drew a nice image of Dojar Cat. Really cool. Greetings, sir. He says, color, enchanted beard looks good. Cutting soda and alcohol makes drastic changes. Yeah, I wonder if I can cut out. Oh, I'd be really grouchy for like a week. If I can cut out like Boomer drink, like if I can cut out zero calorie Monster and rock stars. I mean, that counts as soda, you know, that is sugar. And I think that's probably the biggest cause of my weight gain. People say it's pie, but I don't think it is because I barely eat any pies or sweets these days. It's rare. I mean, I did when Cecil sent over some baked goods. I got into the lobster tails. I ate all 4 of those myself. I ate, I think, 1.5 of the black and white cookies. We tasted the pies. The pies, this place, I hate to, like, I'm grateful to Cecil. Thank you. I don't want to seem ungrateful for gifts. But those guys don't know how to make pies over there. The apple pie was entirely too sweet. Andrea had a piece of it, and she said, this isn't good. And then I was like, well, I'm going to try the pumpkin pie. And the pumpkin pie was dry. Like, the filling was dry. Like, you don't want that. You want a nice wet custard pumpkin pie. And it was just, it was dry. So we didn't finish those. But the cookies and the lobster tails were exquisite. Wandering Comics Gate King Marduk Knight also says, Friday Night Tights don't have a horse in the creative race. Yeah, no, they don't. They're doing, like I said, they're doing their own thing. They want to become commenters. And I want to become a commenter too, or I am a commenter, but to a lesser extent. It's just not the main thing that I do. Ethan is the light bulb that hate moths bump to. Hail chat and mods. Thank you very much. Hate moths. And I'm the sun. I'm the light bulb. Well, let's see. I like dry pumpkin pie. When it's moist, it's gross, says Bootleg Godzilla. So maybe it's just a matter of my own taste. Like every pumpkin pie that I've ever eaten has been kind of like wet. Like, not like soaking wet, but this was dry, and I had no moisture to it at all. So I didn't, it wasn't for me. And maybe it's a good thing that it wasn't for me, so that I didn't have to eat the whole thing, because I would have. I definitely would have eaten that. Dry pumpkin pie equals pumpkin cookie, says the beam pad. You know, had a, yeah, not wet, moist. Moist is a better word. Had I thought of the pie as a pumpkin cookie, maybe I would have been able to finish it. That comparison didn't occur to me. Opinionated News Guy says for $10. Also, I'm beginning to look at starting a YouTube and comics convention in St. Louis with a leftist friend of mine. It would be balanced and no one can complain. Would you come? No thanks. I just can't get out, man. I can't. Today I was asked, like, are you going to do any conventions? And I was like, it's becoming more and more clear that traveling with Ava is just not something that we can do. And not to St. Louis. I couldn't possibly even drive there. I can load up the car and drive to Florida. I can picture myself doing that, and it would be okay because, you know, we could pull over if Ava was having trouble or, you know, whatever. But if we're on an airplane, it would be a nightmare for other passengers. We just don't want to do that. Ava doesn't know chill. Ava makes noise. I don't want to put people through it on a flight anywhere. And the thing is, I don't want to go alone. Me going alone would be cruel to Andrea, who wants to go. One of the things that the only thing that's you know, really kind of hard about having Ava is that Andrea and I were traveling a lot, and she didn't get to travel, and we got married, and we were dating, and we were traveling everywhere. And because Ava has special needs, the traveling has come to an end. We just are not, until she gets a little bit older, we're not going to get to go to Europe. We're not going to get to go to any of these places that we used to go to all the time. And that's a sacrifice. So the idea of me traveling without Andrea would be an insult. It would be painful to her. So I don't want to do that to her. And then me traveling with Andrea and Ava, okay. But the key to it would be, it has to be for work. That's the main thing. There has to be a reason why we're doing it. We're doing it for work. We're going to set up the All Caps Comics booth. We're going to make a lot of money. That's why we're doing it. And then to also have a good time with Andrea and Ava. See? So when, Cecil and Anna, they go out and they get to party, I want to join them too, but it's just not right to do that. I can't do that without Andrea. It's not fair to her, you see. I love that woman. She's a great girl, and she works really hard. Dave the Space Wizard said, was there a specific pirate that inspired you to create Rumblebee? I just got to Chell blasting him in the head and warts and all. That's right. I forgot about that. A specific pirate? No, I don't think so. I always thought of him as just kind of an asshole version of Boba Fett. He's a trashy dude. You know, he's a gangster kind of. I don't know if he's based on anyone. Village Inn pies don't disappoint, says Patrick T. Suck It says, let Cecil down easy. Don't want him to get too chummy. Hunter needs to be babysitter, says Sheila Aliens. Hunter cannot babysit. Hunter falls asleep. Hunter just falls asleep on our couch. It's good to have Hunter there. The key would be to get Ava to baby, or to get Kaylee to babysit with Hunter there for protection. Hunter could be there to make sure nobody breaks in the house, to, you know, really, if any crisis happened, he'd be there. But him watching Ava, he ain't going to do that. You know, that's just not what he does. So yeah, that's the problem with travel. Now we anticipate for the Fans Fest being a great big thing that Andrea and Ava would come to. And because it's our convention, it would be our convention that we helped put together. We'd make sure that there was something for Ava to do. And you guys all know us, and you know, it'd be great for comic skaters to meet the family and all this stuff. You're already in our business quite a bit. You know, we're very personal with you guys, consider you to be family. So that seems like it would be something that we could do, but just random conventions, difficult. Opinionated News Guy says, I completely understand that. What about a Zoom Q&A session? Well, that's what this is. Like, you can ask me questions right now, whenever you want. I'm, you know, I stay very close to you guys through these live streams. Let me see. Who talked about Cecil and Steinvid last night on Kangs? Oh, they did. Okay. Malin did. Yeah, I popped into that late. Are we going to get an EVS Cecil holiday special this year, says Henry Bemis. I certainly do hope so. Some traditions are worth keeping. Cecil and I staying up late, getting drunk, singing Christmas carols was probably one of the highlights. I mean, it was definitely one of the highlights of Comicsgate live streaming. Coming up with Daddy Can't Rape Us All. Amazing. Cecil. Cecil in that silvery, that blanket and that weird mask with a Santa Claus hat on. Yeah, that was, I don't think I've laughed that hard in a long time. I don't think I've laughed that hard since, and I've laughed pretty hard at Comicsgate stuff. That was terrific. Chad Townsend's here. He says Cecil looked tubby in the gut in that video. Yeah, Cecil's lost a lot of weight since then. Cecil was kind of we've all known Cecil as being overweight, but he didn't used to be when he was younger. So Cecil losing weight now is strange to us, and gaining muscle, it's strange to us, but that's his natural state of being. That's how he's usually been. Cover badge pepper pot. Imagine being stuck on New Jersey. New Jersey's okay. We got Philadelphia. We got Atlantic City. We got the shore. You know, there are things that we can do here. It's not bad. I like New Jersey. Okay. I'm seeing a lot of stuff about Friday Night Tights. I'll try not to get into that. Because, I mean, half of you are like, you guys are like, Ethan, if you'll just stop dunking on Friday Night Tights or talking about them, they'll be... I don't think that's true. I think, you know, it doesn't matter what I say or do. But out of respect for those of you who are fans, y'all just avoid talking about that from here on out. Poor Cunt says, are you considering having Rainbow the Brute in stores in time for Father's Day gifts? Wow, I didn't think of that. Okay, our new target goal is to get Rainbow the Brute shipped in time for Father's Day. Don't quote me on that, but I'm going to try my best. That's the perfect Father's Day gift. I don't think I'll have it in stores ever, but it would be great to ship to, you know, backers in time for Father's Day. That'd be really awesome. Chuck Finley says, stand with Gina, but get a season pass to Disney World. Fucking pathetic. Yeah, I know. It's hard, man. I can't judge. I mean, I do judge, but I can't. It's so hard to just, you know, it's like, I want to go see the Indiana Jones movie. And it's like, it's connected to evil. Yeah, but it's also connected to Harrison Ford, who I really like Harrison Ford. And I love Indiana Jones. I want to go see that movie. And I'm not going to see it. Like, I gave myself a special dispensation to go see it. And then I remembered, I made an oath. Like, I can't go see that movie. It's hard to just, it's hard to cut yourself of that stuff, just to deprive yourself of that kind of culture. It's a challenge. And a lot of people who are on YouTube will say things like, I want to stop, but I've got to serve my fan base. So you guys, I'm doing this for you. I'm watching this Disney stuff for you guys because you want me to. You want to hear what I think of it. You know, that's a, you know what that is. That is a prevarication, but whatever, you know. Did Hunter get back together with the ex, says Omer Glitch? No, Hunter's dating like crazy right now. Hunter's dated like 6 girls in the past month. And every single time, like, he throws them out. I'm like, is this one isn't the one? Nope, Dad, nope, she wasn't the one. All right. Elizabeth Lyons says, just ordered 3 Wreck Planet books, and you're going to sign them too. Yay, love you, Uncle Ethan. Oh, thank you, Elizabeth Lyons. I appreciate you. Yeah, the link is up at the top there. If you guys would like to back Wreck Planet, I would certainly appreciate it. We still have, we got a lot of the Jay Lee ones. I think I ordered like 1,000 more, like 1,000 extra Jay Lee books, but some of them are pretty rare. Sorry to hear about Jim's South in Philly. I hope you tried their cheesesteaks before it burned down. Oh, I didn't know it burned down, El Petty Cap Avenger. That sucks. I'm sure that wasn't at all mob related. I'm sure that was just a natural occurrence. Yeah. I'm sure that a famous cheesesteak restaurant in Philadelphia burned down of its own, just natural. How do you feel about Trey Turner and the Phillies? Hero Guy. Did they finally sign him? I don't know. I don't have any opinion about him. I'm looking forward to this season, though. I'm really looking forward to, first of all, once Christmas and New Year's are over, I could give a fuck about the winter. I don't care about anything. January sucks because, as I told Shane Davis, you cannot launch a crowdfund in January. You can't. Everybody's broke from Christmas. It is the worst time to try to sell anything. So basically, you know, you have to do as much selling as you can in December to last you through January. It's just an impoverished month. Nothing to do. So I don't care about January at all. And nothing goes on. It's just cold. It snows. You got to get out there and shovel. That sucks. It's depressing and miserable. Really, I have no use for February. March is the worst because you're never quite sure like when spring is going to finally break. But when April comes around and the sun is shining again and it's baseball season, that is what it's all about. April might be one of my favorite months. And it's Andrea's birthday. Everything is just good in April. Beowulf 13 says, Comicsgate is the movement. Anyone against the movement, even slightly, fuck them. Yeah. Move to Florida, Uncle E. We would love to have you, says John Porton. Hey, thanks. Yeah, if we move anywhere, it's going to be to Florida. We're here. Like, we're happily stuck here. First of all, I really like my house. I grew up in probably the worst imaginable circumstances. If you've read Noah's One Dirty Tree, that was just the tip of the iceberg. Like, I grew up in a house that it was so embarrassing that, like, I would date girls. I couldn't bring them home. Like, I just didn't want them to see where I lived. It was so depressing. I think Noah actually did a strip about me, like, dating and just, you know, me being asked to be let off. Like, she was driving me because I didn't have a car. And me being asked to be let out, like, a block away from my house because I didn't want her to see where I lived. It was a really sweet comic that Noah did. But lived in the worst circumstances imaginable, utterly poor, broke, and with parents that were depressed and, you know, all this stuff. It's the worst thing in the world. So this home that I'm in right now, and I'm in it because of comics, and I'm in it because of Comicsgate, I'm in it because of everything that is going on here, is the best place I've ever lived in my life. It's wonderful. It is wonderful. Every day I wake up happy because, you know, I'm where I am. Like, I'm in a beautiful place. It's just fantastic. And everyone around me is nice. So I'm not anxious to leave, but we are stuck here until Kaylee becomes 18. When Kaylee turns 18, we're allowed to move if we want to. Kaylee's father and Andrea, we all have an agreement that we're going to stay put. He wants to move too. I think he wants to move to North Carolina or something. But we can't, not until Kaylee's 18. And that's 2 years. So in 2 years, if we wanted to move to Florida, we could. We could sell this place. By the way, it's worth like almost twice as much as what we paid for it. We could move to, I would say that my vote would be that we move to Florida, you know. I was actually happy in Florida. I thought it was really great. Andrea's worried about it because she's like, she's heard about the hurricanes and she's like, I don't want to live where there are hurricanes. But listen, we get tornadoes here. I've never seen so many tornadoes since I moved here. And houses just destroyed. And then, of course, the Jersey Shore will flood all the time. Porkon says, I know Manly Men's stores that would be keen to stock Rainbow for Father's Day. Interesting. I'd be cautiously looking forward to The Dial of Destiny, to be honest, even though Raiders is my number one indie movie, says Donnie Pearson. The way I look at Indiana Jones 5 is, it's like... It's kind of like if you found out that there was a Beatles song. Oh, you know what it is? That might be a better comparison. Hey, look, the Beatles, three of the Beatles are getting back together in 1995, and they're going to sort of do these Beatles songs. It's the Beatles, but it's never going to be quite the Beatles, but it's still really cool. Now, that was great. I actually really like those two new Beatles songs. I still listen to them pretty heavily in rotation. But like that situation with a feminist producer rewriting some of John Lennon's lyrics or something like that, fucking with what John Lennon's doing, something like that, I'd still want to listen to the Beatles songs. I would just be annoyed by them. So the new Indiana Jones movie is kind of like that. I want to see it because I love Indiana Jones. I love Harrison Ford. But I know it's going to annoy me. And I'm not going to consider it to be valid or as good as Raiders Temple of Doom, which I do like. Of course, the best one is the third one. But I still want to see it. Yeah, I don't know. That's how I feel about it. All right, hold on a second. Let me catch up with you guys. Master Boob says, you hear the NYPD evidence storage building burn? No, I didn't hear that. Is that true? The mob is very active lately, I think. John Delarose says, let's go E. Hey, John. Yeah, I checked in on John. John, I got to watch your show. I know you did a new Liam stream. I hope it's good. I'll probably watch that when I'm drawing tonight. Opinionated News Guy says, the Phillies and the Mets are going to be on signing sprees. The NL East should be interesting. Yeah. Sheil Alien says, oh, I read some of it. He said you dated weird emo girls. Just one. And like Noah was a little kid. So he remembers this one girl in particular. Her name was Melissa. I dated two Melissas. One was like the bishop's daughter. I mean, she's a blonde haired Mormon. The nicest girl ever. She was really sweet. I will not say one negative thing about her. And, she got married. She's got like 9 kids, lives in Utah now. So good for her. But the other Melissa that Noah was referring to, Melissa N, her last initial was N. Her brother was named Chell, K-J-E-L-L. So Chell Sin is named after Melissa's brother. I almost said her name. I just thought Chell was a hell of a cool name. She was a very strange girl. And I did bring her around. And I guess she had an impact on Noah. Like Noah saw her and thought she was like a witchy kind of weirdo girl. She's very goth. Would write me poems in her own blood. Or they would be in red ink, but like her blood would be on them. She's like, I'm bleeding on this for you. Like, ew, where are you bleeding from? Ray says, move back to North Carolina. You can be neighbors with Shane. Yeah. North Carolina wasn't so bad. It just was boring. It's too boring for me. It's nothing to do. In Florida, there's something to do. And in New Jersey, there's something to do. Like, I can go to Atlantic City. I love Atlantic City. I can go to Philadelphia. I love Philadelphia. There is no culture in North Carolina. Yeah, so Melissa was a strange girl. I don't know what happened to her. I have no idea if she's a... I do remember she bruised easily. Like, we'd be making out and stuff, and she'd be like, I got bruises on, like, what? And I was skinny. Like, you could go, well, it's because you're fat. No, I was, like, a waif. I was, like, waif thin back then. Yeah. What the fuck, E? What's wrong with you? I was listening to goth music back then. I really enjoyed, like, I wanted to date a goth girl and see what it was like. But, you know, you find out that most of them are mentally ill and have depression, and I was not mentally ill, nor did I have depression. So I was always somebody trying to help somebody who had mental illness and depression. Like, let me help you, cheer you up. Pete Callen, the mange man, says, Smiller's on Well Reds. You're missing out. Oh, shit. I can't go. I got to finish this video. I would like to go and see that, but I got to get this video on the record. Oh, boy. EBS sus boyfriend of goth girls. It was just that one time, and then every other girl that I dated was more or less like healthy as a teenager. You know, But yeah, like that's the one that I guess Noah like really remembers. Because Noah's stuck in this one time period, in one dirty tree for the most part. She didn't last long. I only dated her for like a year when I was like 15. Oh, our first date together. She took me to see Defending Your Life. So she, you know what? I really like girls who bring some culture, who teach me a thing or two about a thing or two. Like I never would have watched an Albert Brooks movie. But Defending Your Life was in the movie theaters, and she's like, I want to take you to see this movie. And so we picked her up. I was only 15, I think. We picked her up. My mom drove us to go see Defending Your Life. God, that's weird. I liked that movie, too. I haven't seen it since, but I liked it when I saw it. Yeah, Defending Your Life. I think it was 1991. Look it up and find out what year it was, because that's the year I dated Melissa, which is interesting. I could compare that to how old Noah was then. Opinionated News Guy says, I dated a goth girl back in 94, and she also bruised easily. Like she was anemic or something. I was so afraid her parents would think I hurt her. She was so into typo negative. She got me into good music. She taught me about... the Pixies, the Pogues. She got me into good music. She would make me mixtapes, which, man, things were better back then. I was talking to Andrew about this. It's like we're trying to Christmas shop. And I've, you know, it used to be easy to go Christmas shopping because, you know, one of the best gifts that you could get your kids, your teenagers, would be electronics. Oh, look, it's a new stereo. It's a Walkman. It's a new TV. Kids don't need any of that because of Apple products. Oh, it was 1991. Yeah, that's what I thought, 91. Kids don't need any of that because of Apple products. How old was I in 91? 74. Was I 17? Was I 16, 17? I was between 16 and 17 when I was dating Melissa, I guess. Weird. Wandering Comics Gate King Marduk Knight says, was she a... Yeah, Sisters of Mercy, she got me into... She made me a mixtape with Lucretia, My Reflection, on it. And I was like, what is this? Lucretia, My Reflection. I was like, what is this? This is awesome. And I got into Sisters of Mercy because of her. That was one of the things. Sisters of Mercy, not Christian Death. I never heard Christian Death. Is this the Frog Present girl? Lore. Frog Present. She gave me a frog... She gave me a leather frog necklace. It was like a stuffed frog. No, not that one. I know what you're talking about. You're talking about you're talking about a different girl. You're talking about the Puerto Rican girl. Melissa was a redhead. She was definitely white in every single way. I was always into frogs. So I remember Melissa gave me this stuffed. It was kind of like a cut out of a frog, but it was made of leather and stitched together, and it was on a rope that you wear around your neck. And I wore it until it broke. I really liked it. Adrian Stone says, now it's a $1,200 phone. Yeah, like, you can't just get, like, it'd be so easy to get Hunter, hey, look, I got you a new camera, or I got you, see, in the old days, that's what you would do. Now there's really nothing. Like, what do kids want? Well, I guess, how's their iPhone working? Is their iPhone working? It is. Okay, well then I don't know what to get you because you've got everything on your iPhone. Christmas shopping sucks this year. We're trying hard. What I do with Hunter is I'll get him some clothing. Like he likes Hugo Boss. He likes Hugo Boss. He thinks Hugo Boss is the best designer. So do I. So does his dad. He likes that. That's expensive. So you can get him a Hugo Boss jacket or something. And that's like a big gift. And then he likes, you get him toys. You get him like Legos, like a really good Lego set, you know. Dark Gift Comics Presents is just a scrub through to catch up. Good to see you, taking on the offense. Hey, Dark Gift. Remember when I told you there was some interesting news? That's what it was. Thanks, pal. Thanks for the assist. Appreciate you. James Johnson says, Defending Your Life is an awesome movie. Did your young self get it? I had to rewatch it years later, and then I could laugh. Yeah, I think I was really, I enjoyed it. I was amused by it. And later on, I met Albert Brooks at an airport. I've told this story before. Like, I was in an airport, Burbank Airport, which is a small airport in California. And I was sitting there waiting for my plane. I think I had to wait like 4 hours because it was delayed. And this crazy person came through, like I said, small airports. You took notice of people that came into your gate. This guy comes through and he was absolutely insane. He was wearing like Bermuda shorts and an old white t-shirt that was ripped up. He had a hat on and sunglasses. And I was like, wow, this guy's homeless. Like, how'd he get through? And then I took a second look at him. I'm like, holy shit, that's Albert Brooks. And he was there with his family. He had this beautiful wife and then like a whole gaggle of children. And I went, that's Albert Brooks. And, you know, what am I? He's sitting down there waiting for his plane. And so I was like, what do I do? I got to get his autograph. And I walked over to him and very without interrupting him, I just looked at him kind of like with this look on my face, like, is this okay? And then I had a pen and a piece of paper like saying, can I have your autograph? Kind of, is this okay? Or I'll just fuck off. Like, if you tell me, go away, I'm with my family, I will, you know, just I'm hopeful. His wife laughed like, we can't go anywhere without this. She was very sweet. And he said, sure. He's like, who, you know, what's your name? And I said, Ethan. I said, my first date with my girlfriend was to see Defending Your Life. And he's like, did you get laid? And I was like, I think I did. Yes. He's like, good. I'm glad. Hold on a second here. We got somebody in the back room. I want to. Good. It's Shane. Hey, Shane.
What's going on?
We're catching up on this. First of all, it's great to hear from you, Shane.
Wait, why? We were just on stream like yesterday.
Yeah, I know. I just like it. You know, I like when you come in here. You're a good guy. It's great to hear from you. What I'm doing here is I drew under Pantaclaus the other day, but the stream got banned. It got blocked in most countries because of the music I was playing. I was playing Christmas music, you know. Some people complained and said, now I can't. Well, I wanted to watch you draw it. So what I've done is I'm speeding it up and I'm putting it on the record. I'm talking while I'm watching the video of me draw so that it's out there. So if anybody wants to watch Under Pantaclaus get drawn, it's no longer blocked. The video is there. What do you think of that idea?
You beat the system.
We'll get it out. I just turned the volume down. You know, that's all I did. You know, so that whatever music can't be heard. And I sped it up twice speed so that it's not so ponderous.
Travis, I came in late, so I don't know. I'm sure I've missed 99% of whatever this stream was about.
Oh, yeah. The stream was about the Preston Poulter lawsuit, you know, which I think I mentioned in private.
I kind of understand it a little bit.
Several millions of dollars for maliciously infringing on the Comicsgate trademark, which I own. And
you ever think, like, what if he just really wanted to get not just fucked, but fucked by life? Like, I mean, when you're like that, like, maybe, yeah, like, there's a metaphorical being fucked that you're antagonizing.
Yeah, life. Why would you do that? Like, what exactly do you, it, why is it so important that you fuck with me that, like, basically you're now being sued for several million dollars from your trust fund, which is what's going to happen. I don't know how much his trust fund is worth, but he does have some money. And we can prove everything that we're alleging.
Mm-hmm.
And he's going to lose. So, like, how important is it to fuck with me? Why don't you just leave me and Comicsgate alone and do your own thing? What do you think of that idea?
You've never really up and talked about this, but so, like, now, like, you officially do have, well, since when? Like, how long has that been that you have the trademark?
I've had the trademark, common law trademark since 2018, and I defended it against Vox Day. The paperwork still exists. It has been mine. I've claimed it. And in fact, the USPTO has not awarded it at all to Preston Poulter, unlike despite what he says, that is not true. And then also, two people actually did go ahead and try to register it. One of those people is Dark Gift Comics, who's in the chat right now. Dark Gift Comics registered it, And it was actually this one version of Comicsgate was awarded to him, and he did sell a comic book with Comicsgate on it, and then he passed that on over to me too. So it is mine. It is registered as such.
What are you going to do with all that power?
What I'm continuing to do, which is to make independent comic books that are outside of the control of SJWs. That's my entire point of this. I want to make independent comic books that align with the ideals that we talk about every single day on these streams. And I will kindly license the word if somebody else wants to use it to make a baseball cap or something like that, as long as they're Comicsgate. You know, it's like we can have that conversation. We can draw paperwork, and I will make it so that you can sublicense or license the term Comicsgate, as long as you are Comicsgate. Preston is not Comicsgate. He does not align with our values. He is using it fraudulently, and he's doing it with malice aforethought. So fuck that guy. Let me see. Swinedog 712 says, Albert Brooks is a genius. Here's a bit of trivia. His real name was Albert Einstein before he changed it. No, I didn't know that. Opinionated News Guy says, did you hear Tommy Lahren got fired from the Blaze for being pro-choice and now she's suing them? No, I didn't hear that. That's unfortunate that she's pro-choice. I mean, anytime me, Hail Comicsgate says, Dark Gift. Dark Gift with the assist there. Thank you, pal. Tony Watsuda says, met Albert Brooks at a grocery store. Told him Lost in America was one of my favorite films. Nicest guy. Yeah, he is approachable, which I respect. I appreciate it. You know, he kind of showed me that, if a fan comes up to you and wants and tries to meet you in public, that is how you treat them. You give them a couple of, you talk to them a little bit, you give them their autograph or picture, whatever, give them a huggy, whatever they're looking for, because they make the world go round. Play Shane's intro, the new one, says Ray. I don't have it.
What's the new one?
I want to F you in the A and you dancing.
That's not nice.
Yeah, that's not your intro. That was just a joke. Like, your intro is, you let your dog about.
Right. Everybody jokes around too much here. That's the problem. We need to get serious.
You think so?
Well, yeah. I feel like everything's so serious right now, like in Comicsgate, like everybody's so serious. Like sometimes I just want to break out and laugh. So yeah. I have a good time.
Alfred Ortiz says gatekeeping begins. Alfred, listen, we've always gatekept. How do you not gatekeep? You have to gatekeep SJWs from Comicsgate. That's the entire point of Comicsgate. We've always gatekept. Gatekeeping isn't a problem. It's who gets to be the gatekeeper and over what issues. Frankly, the mainstream comic book industry should not be gatekeeping conservatives. But a movement like Comicsgate should definitely be gatekeeping SJWs because they're the ones who gatekeep conservatives. Ridiculous.
Well, plus, I mean, do we want those guys over here? Like,
they're destructive. Like,
because they're a parasite, they're eventually going to jump when the host dies, which it is. They're going to jump to more of something else, like, you know, something else that has blood to suck. You know, like we could end up with like a lot of SJWs here that are just here to capitalize off of what people have built in Comicsgate. You know, the YouTube channels. The network of backers, like all of that.
Yeah,
you kind of have to inspect people anymore. Like, dude, I'm so jaded with life. Like, I'm so jaded with life.
That's
no,
good,
I mean, I think I'm
that's good
I've,
for an artist.
I'm like, I'm in my 40s and like mid 40s, and I'm like, I think I've dealt with so many two-faced people in the American comic book industry. Like, I don't know up from down anymore.
You and me both, pal. Ruby Jade 90 says, read Inglorious Rex today. Loved it. So much heart. 232 is epic.
Oh, thank you. It's up in funding right now. Please go check out Volume 2 if you are a happy customer of Volume 1. That's where I want you.
Grand Inquisitor says, I think I speak for everyone watching that we need to hear Mike Oxmall's opinion on the Pegston Poulter proceedings.
Cecil in here. Send him the link.
If Cecil shows up, then that's fine. Let me see here. Towering Otakon says, all gates have keepers, Ortizo. All gates have keepers. Sir Angus Fungus says, Shane is a gay vampire. How long till you go on Friday Night Tights? Wow, dude.
Oh, me? I don't know. Yeah. Those guys don't like me.
How do you know that?
I'm pretty sure. I was making a list of, I've had this conversation with people in back rooms, but like I don't know, getting around bigger channels and other YouTubers, it's weird. Every now and then you'll come across somebody that genuinely you can tell they really like you, but you can also tell that with YouTube circles, there's a bit of, I don't know, like I'm a YouTuber, you're not, you know, like they have a little bit of an attitude. So like, I don't think those guys, maybe they like me. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't think anyone doesn't like you.
I'm pretty sure they. Well,
I mean, not. I mean, I'm sure there are some people in comics that don't like Yanzi you now.
Has, you know, her issues, but you know, they're not important.
Yeah, I don't think I really don't think the YouTube sphere has issues with you. I just don't think so. And I think Friday Night Tights would have you on, and I think you should go on if offered. Absolutely.
How do you get an offer? I mean, what do you have to do? Who's D? Know. Do you have to S?
Whose D do you have to S? I think it's Az's. I think you have to S Az's D. Pete Callen, the mange man, says, let's take a moment to shout out the one comics gate creator who I know who isn't two-faced. Patrick Thomas Parnell. Optimistic and hardworking dude who's put in the effort. Good on him. Ice Trey says, I missed it when we called him Pressed In Pooper. Well, you can still do that if you want. You know, it's your freedom. You're allowed to say whatever you want to do. Do whatever you want.
I just wouldn't think like making independent comics, you would end up like in a legal situation all that much. I mean, comics, there's money, but like that's part of the issue why so many people get fucked over in comics is there's not enough money to get representation, you know, to get like a legal like advice or a type of agent. That's why so many creators end up getting fucked over is, you know, that there's just usually not that type of money in comics to get legal. Yeah.
Well, I mean, like, it shouldn't happen. Like, this shouldn't happen. Like, there's no reason why. You're exactly right. Like, why would you get into a legal battle in comics? It's just they're assholes who just want to fuck with you when you're comics gate. And that's pretty much all it is. I really do. I mean, this was obviously malicious. This entire thing was a plan. It was a scheme. And it was meant just to hurt Comicsgate, to hurt me, just to bother me. I don't know, to get my attention. So, I don't know what, but
metaphorically, it's like Wile E. Coyote and the Acme product explodes in his face.
Yeah. I mean, that's what it looks like is going to happen. And I, you know, I don't want to, that's the thing. It's a waste of my time and energy, have to protect or else what is this for? The thing about it is like Andrea says, like, what have you been working for? Like, if we were just to walk away from this situation and allow this liar, this guy who, you know, well, he's been very straightforward about why he's doing this. You know, he's been, frankly, maybe a little too honest about it. He's doing this maliciously to hurt me. He's not Comicsgate. He hates Comicsgate, hates comics gators. He's working for the destruction of Comicsgate, which he sees as a hate group. So that is the whole thing. And he knows that Comicsgate is me. He knows that it's, you know, it's mine. He said that. So, yeah, like the only reason to do this is just to fuck with me. That's a shame. I don't want to be doing this. I don't want to get involved in this, but I have to, because this is the entire purpose of my life. You know, this is what we're doing. We've decided that what we're doing is we are going to defend indie comics from SJWs. And if I have to spend the rest of my life doing that, I will.
Legal stuff sucks for a creative person because, like, once you get in a, like, any type of lawsuit or dealings with a lawyer, like, maybe they haven't, you know, they're just, you know, they haven't gotten to going to court or anything, but just every day the emails and, oh, this has happened, that's happened. Well, what does that mean? We'll wait and see what they do. It's like, dude, that's no place for a creative person.
Dark Gift Comics says, it's always been about hurting your wallet, E. Trust me. I did see them talking together like, we're going to drain Ethan. Like, we're going to, what did they say? They said, we're going to drain him.
I've never understood that either. Okay, so you're going to drain somebody. I get it. But, like, the only person you're feeding is a lawyer you don't know.
Yeah, I know, but they're they're taking money from me. Like all of the hard work that I'm doing to like put money in the bank to take care of my family, they want me to waste it defending a frivolous lawsuit against me.
I know, I mean, but that's like what they want to do. But that I get that part of it, but it's like it's a glass half empty, half full scenario. It's like, yeah, you're doing that, but at the same time, like there's a complete stranger that is an unethical, probably lawyer, that's just draining your money. It's like you kind of still, it's like I'd rather kick somebody in the nuts or kick them down a flight of stairs or slash their tires on their car. I would do anything but try to drain somebody through a lawyer for some reason. It seems passive aggressive, petty. It's like go get in a fight with the person for fuck's sake. Whatever you want to do, just be a man about it. Don't like I'm gonna drain them financially with a lawyer. Mwahahaha. That bullshit. It's like, oh my god, dude. Like, come on.
Yeah. Well, I don't think it's gonna work. I think we're gonna win. So
go to law school, kids.
Yeah, go to law school. Yeah, they're the only ones that win these cases. But no, I
know. Like, so they can get them. You know, it's like they have to. These are probably like not this situation, but I've seen situations where it's like you can look at it from the get go, and it's like, dude, the only person coming away with money out of this is the lawyers. You know, yeah. Just think about that, and then try to solve it.
Lombarsi says, "Sorry, I was away, but very curious. What lawsuit against UE is going on now?" There have been a couple of them. One is, but the one that we're talking about right now is Preston Poulter, who is suing me for defamation. And the defamation lawsuit, as he apparently admitted on his Discord, was a trap. The idea was to go after and apply for the trademark for Comicsgate, which he knows does not belong to him. But to go after it and then to use it to publish filth. So he would produce material that I'm quivering with anger when I'm
talking. No, I know what you're talking about. I've heard okay. These books.
He would produce material that most people would be furious about. In my opinion, let me just use in my opinion.
It's not the type of stuff we want around.
Disgusting. It is right. Vile.
Especially if you're a parent. Like
garbage.
Nothing you
okay?
Want around.
So you want to publish that, and then you want to put the Comicsgate logo on it. You want to put a logo that says Comicsgate approved, and it's material that you would be repulsed by, okay? And then I am supposed to, the plan is for me to, which I'm going to do, is say, no, this is disgusting. I'm going to prevent this guy from publishing this this filth. And then he sues me for defamation, which is what happened. And then, I fell into my trap. So that's the lawsuit that's going on right now, defamation. We've answered yesterday. We answered with a lawsuit against him for malicious trademark infringement, trademark or counterfeit, actually, which is even worse. Trademark. See, the thing about filing for a trademark is you have to believe that it's yours. You have to be like if it is being used by someone else, you have to not know that. It's like you can't just file for the McDonald's trademark because you know that it's not yours. You know that it's already in use. You can't file for it. And similarly, you cannot file for the Comicsgate trademark because you know it's already in use. And he said many times he knows that it's me. It's all about me. It's this and that. He knows that it's associated with me. So he filed for it anyway and then began to tell everybody and produce materials with my trademark on it, the Comicsgate trademark, which I have put into commerce already previously. And the problem with that is that what he produces then leads my customers, the people who Comicsgate essentially, to look at that and go, I wonder, is this Ethan approved? This must be associated with Ethan Van Sciver. That is why it's a crime. That is why we are, you know, suing him right now. That is why this is going to court. It is malicious. He knows it's mine. He did it anyway. And some of the stuff that he published was, in my opinion, intended to hurt my reputation and the reputation of comic skaters. That's why we're suing him. We're suing him for several million dollars because there are several counts of this. That's what's going on right now. So we talked about that. If you want to read it, Nick Riccata is going over the lawsuit on his channel tonight, he says.
It's interesting, just the whole Comicsgate situation. Like, I mean, it gets like at first it's just like, hey, just be Comicsgate, make a comic. And then stuff like this comes up and it's like, this is more complicated.
I mean, be Comicsgate. And in order to be Comicsgate, you've got to adhere to Comicsgate values.
Right.
But if you want to make money from the word Comicsgate, it's mine. You have to come and you have to see if we can work something out. That is the situation. I own its trademark because I put it into commerce first. So, Shane, if you want to make a Comicsgate t-shirt, just come to me and say, hey, I want to make a Comicsgate t-shirt. And I'll say, okay, here's my lawyer. He's going to write you up a quick little contract about it. You can license. Actually, my word is good enough, really. A verbal contract, right. Contract is fine. But yeah, go ahead. Make up a, because I know you're Comicsgate. I know that you represent Comicsgate. Everybody knows that about you. So yeah. That's fine. We just want to protect what Comicsgate stands for. And evidently, we have to, don't we?
And Ethan, I would like to extend you the same courtesy. If you decide one day you want to come to me and you're like, Shane, I want to make a Bro Dogs t-shirt. Just, you know, we'll come up with a contract and you can, you know.
Wouldn't that be the thing to do? Shane, what if I did that? What if I infringed on your trademark and started making t-shirts of baby pterodactyl and things that
you would get a call from my
correct. That is correct. That's how it works in the real world.
Okay, for people that don't understand why we're joking like this, is like, I guess, like, if you get a soup, like, you're monetizing, basically it becomes a product because of a live stream, right?
Yeah, because money is being made.
Money's being made. So, and that's kind of the argument behind comics and trademark and copyright is like...
Right, because it becomes associated with a business entity.
Yeah.
That's why. So you can't just, you can't do that. You can't like go, oh, you know what? I want to make McDonald's brand condoms. You know what I mean? You can't do that. It's like,
dude,
because it's associated with the Big Mac.
The Big Mac? The quarter pounder.
Yeah. Dark Gift Comics says, don't forget it has to stay in use. Oh, yeah, of course. We're going to make Comicsgate. Comicsgate is going to be on the comics going forwards. It's important that we do that.
We should get like a CG brand. Like that's once you're in, like you just have to get branded.
That's a good idea too. Yeah, the number of the beast.
Well, no, I mean just CG. Like the number of the beast.
Yeah.
Yeah. Why not?
That's correct.
Why not go biblical? You're right. Let's just bring the Bible into it.
Let's bring the Bible into it and make it happen. Now, I already watched a bunch of videos about the JFK assassination, which somebody sent me all this like occult lore associated with Dealey Plaza and all this stuff that was absolutely insane. I mean,
Was it believable?
Well, look, I mean, you can, if you go down one of those rabbit holes, you go, oh yeah, maybe there's something to this. I mean, there was that, like, you know, there's a pyramid, like an obelisk shape right in Dealey Plaza with a fire at the top. That represents, you know, Freemasonry, and the fire at the top represents Satan. And so, like, it represents Satan's cock right in Dealey Plaza, which is shaped like a triangle with the top cut off because of the overpass, which it's the perfect, like, occult location for the execution of a king, like as a sacrifice to the devil. And I just went, wow, yeah, sure. Lombarshi says, for $5, Ethan only has to consume the market share of all Big Macs ever made, and he can use the McDonald's brand. All right, it's a deal.
You gotta watch out what you agree to now. Like, after that, I heard about the, or saw the trailer for that Netflix documentary, Pepsi in that jet thing or whatever. Like, you have to really watch out, Ethan.
Yeah.
Somebody can hold you to that. It will hold up in court.
What about? What did I do?
Well, this one guy, like, it's something like, you'd have to go pull the trailer up if you really are curious, but it'll probably get your channel hit. But like something like, the chat will understand it more than me because I only saw the trailer. But he basically won a jet from Pepsi back in the day, but then technically they were never going to give somebody a Harrier jet, which a Harrier jet is a very expensive jet because it can take off like,
well, I think most vertically. Jets are expensive, yeah.
But you know, but that one specifically, the thrusters turn down to lift straight up like that. And they're not that safe. So they're expensive and not safe because the engines rotate and the wings. But anyways, he won the contest. Of course, Pepsi's like, dude, that was just a commercial. That was a joke. And he figured out the scam or something where he bought all these Pepsis. And it hired people to buy these Pepsis and give him the receipts. And basically, Pepsi owed him a Harrier jet. Like, just because they said it in a commercial or something.
That's crazy. Yeah. Did they give it to him?
I didn't go through the documentary. I only saw the trailer. I mean, obviously, Netflix made a documentary about it. So I think he got it. I think that's what people told me. He got it. But I mean, it was just like one of those 90s commercials where like a kid comes in with a skateboard. He's like, yeah. And here's a Harrier jet at the end. It's like, oh, cool, man. You know, like that. And then all of a sudden, guy's like, I think I can get Pepsi to give me one if I buy all this Pepsi. Yeah. Like, I think he actually had to buy a Pepsi plant, but it was still the Harrier jet was worth more than what he spent.
200 Watt Studio says McRibbed for her pleasure. I don't like the McRib. I don't know why people act like it's good.
I think they start the word on the street. I've only ever, like, one out of five people will say they like that sandwich. And I'm like, you just bought into the marketing of it. That's what they tell you. They're like, yeah, there's Joe. You know Joe, right? I guess. Joe loves McRib. He's been waiting for it to come back. Okay, I guess I'll order one to see what Joe's talking about. Coming, I don't know. You know how many Joes I know?
How many Joes do you know?
How many Joes do you think you come across in your one lifetime?
A lot. Most people are named Joe or Mike. 200 Watt Studio says Harrier Jet is piloted by Anna. Get it? Harrier Jet? Harrier Jet?
I think Anna's mad at me.
Why? Why was she mad at you? You didn't do anything wrong.
Well, she was yelling like, oh, there's a photo. You need to pull it up. I haven't seen this photo. And she, I was like, no, I shouldn't pull it up. She's like, and then she wouldn't leave me alone until I pulled it up on stream. And like, we would change subjects and she would come right back to it. And I pulled up the photo and it was flattering to a lot of men, but she didn't realize that a lot of men saw that. And it was like a kind of costume malfunction. And I told her, no, I don't want to share it. And she just wouldn't leave me alone.
What do you mean she wouldn't leave you alone?
She kept harassing me. Like, well, who is this person that sent you this photo? And I'm like, it's on Twitter. Well, why didn't they tag me? It was just like, she just wouldn't leave it alone.
Lombarsi says, Ethan, who poses for under Panta Claus references? I know you want me to say myself, but no, nobody really. Opinionated News Guy says Arby's puts out a country rib sandwich at the same time. Way better. Arby's isn't bad.
People argue that Arby's is shit, and I'm like, why? I mean, I try every new sandwich. They have a burger now, like a real burger patty. I ordered it. It was fine. Their buffalo chicken sandwich, it's a fine sandwich. You know, the roast beef's always been fine. Like and everybody's like, they don't have meat. That's not real meat. And I'm like, what do you mean it's not real meat?
What do you think it is? Like, if it's not real meat, what would it be?
Is it ground earthworm? What is it? I have no idea.
All right, hold on a second here. A couple of super chats that I want to catch up with. Yurash Mataru says, no, McRib tastes great. You have crap taste. And Opinionated News Guy says, oh, I read that one already. Okay, am I caught up? I'm caught up. Okay. Shane, I want to show you this. These are great colors by your boy, Jason Wright.
Let me see.
Oh, my God, dude. He's coloring Chad Townsend, or he did color Chad Townsend on this wonderful story that Bill Willingham wrote. And at first, I couldn't figure out a way to show everybody this. There was like a problem, but I think this will work. Let me see. Yeah, and then we hit this right here. All right.
That doesn't look like his work.
I know. Look how great this is, dude. It looks different, right? It looks storybook. It looks aged. Look at the texture back here.
Mm-hmm. No, we've been doing a lot more with texture and stuff lately. Textures is like he's playing with it a lot more than he used to. The sky is really nice, but this doesn't look like his work.
I know, but it is. He's doing this watercolor storybook. Ree says, Anna wasn't mad at you for bringing up the photo, Shane. She was mad because you memorized every contour and used it for your own personal gratification.
That's not true. I deleted it from my computer when she got outraged.
Is that, what do you mean you deleted it?
What, I deleted the photo. I was like, it really upset her, the photo. And I told her, like, don't worry about it. Don't. It's
what
Anna.
Is going on? What are you guys doing? All right, hold on. Look at this. Look at this fantastic artwork here. Oh, it's so good, dude. Chad Townsend and Jason Wright. Story by Bill Willingham. This is from Rainbow the Brute's Cool Story, Bro.
Hey, now.
Which you haven't done anything for yet.
I told Not you yet. What I'm doing, but I'm thinking what angle I want to play it. Like there's because I want to do the Peter Pan thing, but there's a couple of angles. I like the, because of Peter Pan's, you know, leotard and stuff, I like to go the wrestling angle. But then at the same time, then I started thinking of like Mike Tyson's punch out, you know, how radically cool the bad guys were, you know, like, but they were boxers. So then I was thinking about that. But then I think I'm going to stick to the wrestling, but I'm thinking more like a Macho Man, Randy Savage. So then I started going down through this whole weird thing of these oddball wrestling documentaries and funny stories and shit. But I'm the part I'm hung up on is, do I want to deal with Peter Pan's shadow or Captain Hook or just the Lost Boys? Like what angle, what type of references am I wanting to use the Peter Pan references into the Peter Pan wrestling gimmick thing?
You want to have Captain Hook in there.
That's what I'm saying. But then once you put, see, this is a problem. It gets really convoluted then, because then either that or it's just a montage story. But like once you can't have Captain Hook without the Croc, you see, like it like they all start to put themselves into the story, and it's like that's a lot. So I'm trying to think about it. Like I'm in this process of both the fun wrestling shit and then also the Peter Pan fun shit. Like I forgot about his shadow there for a while. Like his shadow got away from him or whatever. Wouldn't he have to fight his shadow?
Yeah.
I mean, shit like that. Like I forgot about. So I was like, huh. But I think it's going to be really more on the funny, oddball, like Slim Jim commercial, funny type thing. I don't think it's going to be serious.
Yeah, it should be fun.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. I want to keep it more like, even like how Macho Man was Bonesaw and Spider-Man, like that type of funny character, mm-hmm. you know. But then it's almost funny. But see, now I'm getting into it too much, and I'm letting it brew. But then there's the whole Queen Elizabeth, the Elizabeth stuff, you know, Macho Man's woman, right? Which would be good for Wendy. But then, it's so organic and it goes together really good. And I'm like fucking around with it right now. I'm like, I don't want to put all this in there. I just need to get.
Don't one hurt bit. Yourself, Shane. Over what? This. Don't hurt yourself. Just remember that, you know, there's at least one comic skater who can honestly say,
I was raised by the wolves, ate till they fool, run through the night, playing with your life, going against the pack, that's risk in your life, better play it right, yeah, you better play it right, I got loyalty and blood.
Thank you, John.
What's up, brother?
Man, Shane's really having a hard time with this story.
I wouldn't call it a hard time. I'm just letting it brew.
Oh, you know, I cracked Black Riding Hood. I don't know, in probably about 30 seconds.
Yeah, like you weren't, there was no real, like you just went with it. Anna and Cecil both treated Shane like a perv, says your Rashma Otaru.
Yeah, it was uncalled for.
You think so?
I think so. I mean, I didn't take the photo.
I just haven't been online with you guys much. I've missed a lot of things. I missed Comicsgate Kings last night.
It was just this week's Jack Show, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was last week's Jack Show.
It was only Thursday.
Yeah, this is weird. YouTube time is weird, man. It fucks with you. One day you feel like you're out a month, but then like 3 days feel like 6 months. Like I was talking to Yonzi, like my voice is cracking. I'm like, I've been on stream for like 7 days straight or something. 5 hours a night, 7 hours a night.
She took everyone's criticisms into consideration. She explained on her art stream right after Social Aliens. What criticism? Criticism over her calendar?
I don't know.
I mean, what is this? What are you guys doing to Anna?
I didn't do anything. It's what Anna's shirt did to Anna.
We're making her better.
Yeah. Ethan was too busy being a fighty old man at a teen concert. Holy hanger dates. I told Andrea that story, and she was like, what would you... She's like, so you're going to get in a fight. She's like, let me get this straight. So you're going to get in a fight at a concert with when you've been entrusted with four teenagers... Mm-hmm. To be their ride home and to escort them safely out of Philadelphia back to New Jersey.
Well, you didn't know what that elderly man was capable of.
No, well, she's like, no, that's not it. I would have been arrested, right? I mean, she's like, mm-hmm. You would have been, what would happen? What would happen if you got in a fight? And then you're arrested and then you're in jail. And then I got to get in the car with Ava. Not even the car. I got to get in the Sprinter van, the company vehicle, because you got the car, a-hole. And I got to get Ava in there, and I got to drive out to Philadelphia at midnight to pick up those girls who are going to be sitting there waiting while you're sitting your ass in jail somewhere in Philadelphia. She's like, that's real good. That's good thinking on your part.
To be honest, I'm taking her side on this. You kind of, I've heard this story from the get-go. You had one job.
Yeah.
And that was to chaperone them, not go in and have fun.
Wait, how old was the oldest... How old was
I would have whipped his fucking ass. I mean, honestly, yeah, these guys are like, I'm Brett. I would have beat this guy's fucking ass. I would have beat him down. I would have beat him senseless. I really would have, man. I would have broken his fucking face in. And I would have done it right in front of all of those 12-year-olds that were around. I would have shown them the meaning of loss. I really would have. I would have see what this guy started with and look what he's got now. I would have demonstrated that in front of all those children who were just there to watch.
Well, he started with teeth and lost his teeth is what you're
saying. Yeah, I would have broken. I honestly would have given nightmares to children over that, because that guy was right in my face and he was sitting there just like, when you go home tonight, you shut the hell. You're not in the front row, dude. You're not. You don't belong here. I don't care. I don't care that you drove a bus with this dude that's on the stage right now. I don't care. Like, where's your press pass? Where's your pass? Your backstage pass? Where's whatever it is that you're supposed to be wearing? You don't need to be in my space. I paid for my seat, and so did all these people. Fuck out of here. People don't go to jail in Philly. City's a joke, says Major Choke Out. you can talk to my wife about that then.
Did they give you a cheesesteak in jail? Like, do you think?
I don't know. Ethan's out of breath talking trash to Snark the Gunty. I would have, honestly, there's no chance, dude. I would have destroyed this dude. I would have. And I don't say that lightly. I understand, man. There's some people who are out of my fight class, you know, but.
What do you consider your fight class is? What would you call that class?
You.
Hmm.
So shut up.
Those are big words.
Oh, wait, you're saying Shane is in your class. Oh, okay. I thought you were saying he was out of your class.
I don't know, man.
Because he's a trained fighter.
I'm just kidding. I'm kidding with Shane. Everyone loves Shane Davis. Hmm. Right, look, here's what we're doing tonight. Tonight, we're celebrating Comicsgate. Tonight, we're celebrating the amazingness of Inglourious Rex. And that is Shane Davis's comic. Shane's been in a bad mood lately.
Who, me? No, I'm just tired.
What?
I haven't been sleeping well like the last like 3 weeks or something. Like I keep waking up. Like I don't know. Like I don't know if it's the weather changing because it's getting really cold where I'm at all of a sudden or what, but So like the house, I'm not used to heating it, and like it's warm when I go to bed and then cold in the middle of the night. Like it's like I can't get used to setting the temperature or something. I just haven't had a good night's sleep in like 3 weeks.
Pete Cowan says people go to jail in Philly sometimes more than once. Thank you, Pete Cowan, for pointing that out. Pete's been to jail a couple of times.
Isn't like, are we getting into that? You know who's been to jail and she knows a lot about it is Mandy.
Sheila Alien says your instincts are keeping you alert to protect pterodactyl, Shane.
Oh, yeah. No. Well, that is true. If I hear her like sing or make a sound, like because sometimes she'll wake up and sing in her crib, I'm wide awake and she's fine. But then it's like, there is some truth to that. You know, like if you, like I could be upstairs napping and like if I can barely hear her downstairs having like laughing, like I'm all of a sudden awake. Like I'm like, oh, what is she doing? What did she get into? Like, you know, it's just, I think it's parental, I guess. I hope.
Yeah.
You're a parent, you tell me.
No, that's how I feel too. I'm fully aware of what my kids are doing at all
times.
No, I'm fully aware of what my kids are doing at all times. All times.
Hmm.
I mean, not really. Ava came down here and broke the paint master that I'd left out. She's no better than Cecil, or Cecil's no better than her. That was depressing. Yurashima Taru says Anna hounded Shane to open photo. She was nipping in the photo because he was sent the photo and opened it in paint, and he was treated like a perv.
So yeah, she was pretty much begging to see it. Hands and knees, just knees all up in the dirt.
And Proby says Comic Skate should have a designated date, which should be celebrated annually. I think it should be the beginning of Pride Month. Just to fuck with Smiller. Opinionated News Guy says Ethan should have ruined his big roadie hind end. He wasn't that big, dude.
Okay, I kind of don't know this part of this story, so I know a guy was interrupting your viewing of this concert, and he goes, "I'm a roadie," and what
he
else?
Didn't say he was a roadie. He goes up, so the guy looked like, I can't even describe him. He looked like a cartoon character. He looked like Pappy from Popeye. He was like he was like that. He's an older guy. He's probably 10 years, 15 years on me, and he was shorter than me too. But he was stocky like a fire plug. And he was basically, we're in the front row. And this guy is, for some reason, he thinks it's within his right. If I'm standing up, he's walking behind me past my seat. There are women that are back there, little kids. And he's there with his photo. He's filming that dude. It's been a long time without you, my friend. And I tell you, he's singing the song. I've used that song in a video.
The theme to Enterprise. It's been a long road.
How does that go?
No, you did that for the Monocles for Somalia, right?
That's right. So the guy who sings some Monocles from Somalia, like he's up on the stage and he's a young man, dude. I don't understand. He's not even that interesting. He's just a kid. He's written some good songs. He's got some hits. So he's headlining this whole show. And the dude is sitting there taking these pictures of him, and there are women who are in front of me who are kind of like security, and they're telling him to sit down. I'm like, sir, you don't belong here. Sir, nope, you're not in the front row. And he won't leave. And he had to be told 3 times. And then he's behind me. Like he would not leave. He's like,
This sounds a lot like me protecting my neighborhood from the coloreds.
I wouldn't say that. Okay. Anyway. So he's behind me, and I say to him, I say, "Hey, man, you were told 3 times." I said something to the effect of, and the music's really loud. You were told 3 times. You don't belong here. You want to be here. You got to buy a front row ticket. But you know what? You're in front of, you're bothering the people behind me. You're bothering me. So why don't you get the fuck out of here? And the guy was really weird. He was just like, he said, "Let me tell you something. The guy that you're watching right now," and he had this Irish fucking like Boston accent that pissed me off.
Gross.
Fuck you. And he's like, guy that you're watching right now, I brought him here in 13 trucks. The reason why you're watching this show is because of guys like me. I brought him up here 13 trucks. And I was just like, fuck. I said, dude, sit the fuck down. And then the woman was like, you gotta sit down. And I was like, dude, you're gonna sit down right now. Go over there. Go over to the side of the stage or whatever. There are people over there hanging out. But I said, you gotta get out of the front row. And the dude gets real mad and he's like, let me tell you something. When you go home tonight and you're resting your head on your pillow, I want you to remember that you sent a working man. You think you're better than me? You told a working man to go hit the fucking bricks out of the front. And he's in my ear. And then I got the bass of the fucking Charlie Puth coming out of. And I just said, I'm going to fucking hit you if you don't get the fuck out of my fucking face. Like, I'm yelling at him now. And then this big black dude came and told, sir, you got to leave and save the whole day. Okay. Save the whole day.
Whoa. Saved by a black man. Look at that.
Saved by a black man.
I'm just a working man. I want you to remember that you told a working man.
Get the fuck out of here, dude.
What does that even mean? I'm a working man.
The guy was insane. I don't even know, but he was like, when you go home, I hope you feel guilty about this. I'm like, I'm not going to feel.
He's probably presuming that because if he works for the dude, he's been to a lot of concerts and people in the front row are paying top dollar. So they're presumably, you know, executives or, you know, making good money.
Pete Callen, the mange man, says, can we add a new CG rule? We don't threaten to sue Patrick Thomas Parnell. It may seem specific to some, but trust me, it's a rule CG apparently needs. What do you think about that?
I think lawsuits are gay. That's what I think.
Yeah.
I think people threatening to sue people is kind of gay.
Wait, now hold on a second. Now, the whole beginning of this live stream was me suing Preston Poulter. You think that's gay?
A little gay.
Oh, that's a counter suit.
Oh.
Yeah. That's you acting on somebody. I mean, that's somebody came at you, you played defense, now you're playing offense because they came at you. I mean, that's a little different if you, I don't know. I don't want to get into this.
Shane's been very upset about this. He's like, I wake up to drama. I go to sleep to drama.
He's drawn to drama because he's
like he's like if there's drama, like Shane needs like peace. He really needs to just sort of chill because there's been drama in Comicsgate every single goddamn day since 2017. It hasn't stopped. It hasn't really. I mean, actually, we had a few good months where for some reason SJWs in particular were just kind of like. Maybe we should just shut up because, like, they're just getting better and better.
Yeah.
But there's been drama. Ghost House says, countersuit is a reach around at best. I think you're good. All right. Thank you, Ghost House. That's close.
I don't like people that throw idle threats of lawsuits. Like, I'm not a big fan of litigation.
I hate lawsuits, dude. Hate them.
I feel like that people that do that haven't ever spent any time going to court. On anything, and you understand like that. If that's your first place to go in a situation, you either have a free attorney or you have no fucking clue how lawyers charge. Hmm.
Sheeple Hunter says, "Why do you hate us, Ethan? What are you talking about? I love you. What did I do to make you think that I did not? I don't care. My goodness, what was it letting Shane talk uninterrupted for 5 seconds?
And look, all the backers of mine that are lawyers, I love you." But I'm not wanting to hire you.
Here's a question. Opinionated news guy for $2. I can't help it. I'm being roped into this with super chats. People pay money and I got it. I don't want to talk about this. But people are paying good $2 for me to just talk about this. Who was suing Patrick Thomas Parnell? The answer to that specific question is nobody is. Thank you. Steve Roberts for $10 says, please sue Friday Night Tights. Thank you, Uncle Lee. Yeah, that's where that's going from here. Yeah, I mean, I can't help it. I do have people asking questions, and if people ask questions, I got to answer them if they pay for them. I'm not answering questions just in the chat. I don't want to indulge in that, but I mean, here's the thing about this.
You would be a hell of a witness.
Yeah. Like, I just answered the question.
I gotta throw money up at the podium to get you to tell the truth.
I'm saying I don't. I'm gonna answer specific questions. I will, but you have to pay for them, and I will answer the questions without embellishment.
Oh my god!
I will not add to the questions. But that is just the way it is because unlike some of you, I respect the super chatter. I read all the super chats, even when they call me fat and gay. And I answer the super chats.
He's kind of like that Will Ferrell character from Austin Powers where, you know, he's never going to tell you the answer unless you ask him, what was it, three times? You ask him three times, he breaks.
No, you can ask me once. But let me see this question here for $2, Jared Weaver. What is the Gabe and Smiller deal? I'm unaware of any deal between those two gentlemen.
I see what you're doing. That's a play on words.
Opinionated news guy, hire Tom Tuttle. Tom Tuttle is somebody that you could hire for certain legal. Yes, I will tell you that about Tom Tuttle. If you had some legal problems, you could go to him. Okay, that's who he is.
Tom, I love you.
Yeah. Sue Phil Diaz for sock rape, says Snark the Con DM.
Well, it depends on the age of the sock. Like, you know.
Yeah. All right, let's take a look at Smiller and see what Smiller's up to today. Smiller was accused, and he was like, hold on a second. Smiller was accused, by the way, he started with this. Grim Bastard points out, John, I don't know if you saw this. Were you part of this? Did you see this situation?
Yeah, I saw it. What was it, last night?
P. Cowan says, will Gabe be invited on Kings for $2? Gabe is part of the Kings chat room, and as usual, he will at this time receive the link to go on Kings if he would like to. Okay, so this is a piece of artwork that was done by Mike S. Miller, and somebody points out, Grim Bastard points out, that Robin's leg is missing. His second leg is missing. John, what do you think of this?
I think it's a terrible drawing. How this guy ever got work for DC at this point in his career boggles my mind.
Yeah. Maybe to opinionate, it says, was it Mandy and Darkgift that helped with the trademark? They definitely were helpful. Everybody was helpful. I appreciate all of you. Yeah, this is really bad, dude.
And gay.
Yeah.
It is. It's definitely Mike's stuff does have some gayness to it. Yeah,
there's some dick sucking lips in there. It's over Robin's crotch. The water guy's butt is presumably, presenting.
Look at Robin's super muscular arm here. He's like jacked, man. He's got Captain America arms and a little twink body.
How long do you think Mike had been drawing professionally at this point?
This is probably the first thing he's ever done.
No, I think it's like the latest thing, probably. Yurashima Taru says the leg isn't missing. It's up that guy's ass. See? Oh. He's got his leg up Aqualad's ass. I didn't realize that.
Oh, so that's this why was like, ooh.
Yeah. All right. So Mike S. Miller responds to these allegations today on Twitter. He says, isn't it strange how that rock looks like a calf? The inker screwed up. Jimmy. That's our Jimmy Reyes, who did
Jimmy vote. Reyes inked this?
Wait, yeah. When? Definitely he pulled this out of a file last night to, dunk on Miller when he was the inker.
No.
Because technically, hang on. During this time at DC, if you're an inker and you see something that fucked up, you're supposed to fix it.
Yes.
Wait, can we click on that again? I want to see where this missing leg is at.
Right. So behind Robin are rocks, as you can see. Braden Dykstra says, hey, Mike. Yeah. Can you see it, John?
No. Can't tell.
All right. Well, then you're dumb, according to Mike. Isn't it strange how that rock looks like a calf? The inker screwed up. Jimmy is an idiot. And so is everyone who didn't notice the calf-shaped rock where the other leg should have been inked. Y'all so dumb, it's pathetic. Does Mike seem triggered here?
Yeah. Very really upset does. About this old piece.
The inker was David. I know it's old, right? Like, why do you give a... Like, yeah. Yeah,
I got some real gems out there. You know what I mean? But I'm not going to be... Like, oh!
So Mike goes, for those who are too dumb to see which one I'm talking about. And then he posts this.
This very blurry thing. I see jizz. I don't know.
I hate people that do what he just did, and that's one thing I don't like about Mike. He calls people dumb and stupid if you don't see things his way. And it's a manipulation tactic.
And nobody sees it his way. Like, there's no way that you saw this his way.
No, but like, somebody will be, well, I don't want to be dumb, so I guess I agree with Mike. You know, you see the, you see how it works? You're stupid if you don't see it his way. It's like, dude, come on.
Can he do a draw over on it so we can
see that's what's going to happen next. You'll see this. I said, can you make it more clear? Honestly, I can't see it. Maybe I'm just too dumb, which Mike would be quick to agree with. Sometimes a rock is just a rock, so 709.
Oh, I thought that was Miller.
That would have been great if he had done that, but he doesn't do that. Yeah. You know, 709 just rules.
Somebody in the chat said, Mike said I'm dumb. If that's true, I think he's a bad artist, but whatever.
Yeah. Classy as ever. Shitting on everyone must be a working strategy. Hope you lose tons of money, you vile shithead.
Wow.
Some people who are really taking Mike to task there.
Oh, can you scroll up? It looked like Jimmy had posted on there.
Oh, where did he post on there? Hold on. Y'all so dumb and pathetic. Hold on. There he is. I was there when Salim inked it. I saw the raw pencils. I remember Salim telling you, you forgot the leg. Just remember that page the next time you want to judge someone else's art.
Well, oh, so Jimmy didn't ink it.
No, Jimmy's friend Salim did. Jimmy's going in on Mike. He said, just remember that page. Just remember, you ain't perfect neither.
Yeah, and I forget that Jimmy's really old. You know,
is he really?
Yeah, he's like 50 years old. He doesn't look it.
No, he doesn't. He looks like a little kid.
Mm-hmm. I got a question. Like with Jimmy, who's taller, Mike or him?
Mike, I think. Mike is 5'6", I think. And I think Jimmy said he was 5'4".
Tallest munchkin in munchkin land.
Mm-hmm.
Steve Roberts says, is it possible that Smiller is still angry over being repeatedly defeated by the great John Livingston Malin on Drawn and Quartered? John, I'll turn that over to you.
Oh, yeah, he's damaged.
Yeah.
Damaged goods, guys. Just turn your back and walk away.
This is because Mike is chasing down Gabe El Tayeb over this. Like, this is David Williams' artwork. Mm-hmm. Gabe is drawing some Truth, Justice, American Way. Mm-hmm. This is his artwork, and Mike is cracking on his artwork there.
Yeah, fair enough.
I will say, like, yeah, there's no possible fucking way on this hemisphere, on this planet even, that Gabe could ever draw as well as David Williams. It's just not what
I saw another piece that he did that actually looked pretty good, so.
Well, no, I have too, but it doesn't matter. It's like, I've seen some good work from myself, but I don't think on my best day, I'm as good as Adam Hughes on his worst day. You know, I don't think so. Well, maybe I am. Well, yeah, I definitely am. Most days I'm better than Adam Hughes, come to think of it. Is anybody going to stop me and just let me say stupid shit?
No, just keep talking.
Okay. What you ordered, what you get. Okay, so Mike is really upset over this whole thing here. And it is tragic.
So is it, I get, like, I said this to a friend the other day. It's a lose-lose situation. You're never going to win, like, if you're the artist that covers an artist that isn't in the book anymore. So, like, without getting way into, I get what Mike's saying, but is the problem the quality of the artwork or the fact that the art switched?
I don't know. Mark Walters is like, Jesus, what a lunatic. Mark, you mean me? I'm the lunatic? Just because I said I'm better than Adam Hughes every single day of my life?
No, I think he's talking about Mike.
There's two Adam Hughes, though.
There's Adam Hughes that does covers, and then there's Adam Hughes who does interiors. I don't like his interiors.
Honestly, Adam Hughes is like a fucking god, dude. Dude's amazing.
David Mack liked his interiors a lot.
He sure did. Yeah. What is... Yeah, anyway. So this is going on. For those too dumb to see which one I'm talking about. So this is important. Make it more clear. Honestly, I can't see it. I would just like Mike to make things more clear to everyone. I like asking Mike questions. When Mike says shit like this, just go, well, what do you mean? And just ask him to keep digging.
It's over really and funny. Over again?
Yeah.
Oh, is that it? Is that the drop?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So this is hold on. Artist Zero was like, there's no way it would work. And then he did this. Like he said, it just, you know, he said, that's the best that you can basically do with it. Here's the leg that it would never actually. So
that little shape is the calf muscle. All right.
I mean, if you say so, but.
Yeah, but where would the top part of the leg be?
Wait, scroll down. Doesn't Mike do another one?
Yeah, I think so. Hold on a second. Yeah, Mike didn't realize. Until next time, Jimmy is a bitter hobbit. He's so this is what Mike did. This is what Mike did.
Mike, that's a terrible save. And, see, and he's the artist. He's the one trying to make his own case. That looks awful.
No, what it is all of this stems from Mike was taller than somebody and he can't let it go. He has to call him a bitter hobbit. He waited his whole life.
Oh shit. Yeah, you might be right.
Yeah, bitter hobbit. All right. Jimmy is, why, you know, it's funny to see Mike getting mad at everyone.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I really like it. Mike is like angry at Jimmy. He's angry at Gabe. I understand why he's angry at Gabe. He's here to stick up for David Williams on this True Justice thing. But it's always surprising. It's like, oh, he hates Jimmy too. Like, what did Jimmy do to? My goodness. But this is the best thing that happened. Smiller and Mark Brooks team up.
Yeah.
Did you see this, John?
No. Is this new?
Yeah this was yesterday. You know, Mike S. Miller is basically saying that, you know, if whatever problems are going on with True Justice in American Way, it's my response. It's like, I got nothing to say about it. It's not our place. I'm pretty sure this is the first time in CG history those words ever came out of Ethan's lips. Lol. Backers are going to get screwed. Too bad CG isn't a fan movement anymore. Mark Brooks shows up and goes, I can't believe I'm agreeing with you.
Oh, Mark Brooks is feigning concern for the people of Comicsgate now.
Yeah, that's right.
Wait, you care about all these Nazis and racists and homophobes now? Mark?
Please. And then Mike liked this. He gave it a heart.
We're friends. Maybe I can get work at DC again.
Mike S. Miller goes, lol, I can't believe I'm not blocked by you. And then there's like another.
Oh, let's ask some D's.
It is kind of gay. Some people did point out that it does seem kind of gay. Saying isn't it's a Smike rejoint.
Isn't it kind of weird that like Brooks is just like circling around for this shit? Like whenever he sees the train slow down, he can jump on for a second.
Yeah. Like, I mean, look, this is the whole thing. Like, Comicsgate is surrounded by people. Like, you can list them. We can make a list of them. Like, they're just, they're kind of orbiting like sharks. They're waiting to smell blood, and they'll all, it doesn't matter. Like Panboy, whatever his name is hanging out with Mike now. Now,
wait, far be it war campaign?
Yes.
Really?
Yes. Far be it for me to have a memory. But, I mean, he's up in there like, yeah, Mike. That's right, Mike. You're so right, Mike. Far be it for me to have a memory that's, you know, that goes back further than, say, a goldfish's memory. But wasn't the reason why Mike had a problem with Comicsgate largely because of Panboy?
Very largely. Yeah, just the entire war campaign as a whole, man. Like that was like, they got to go or I got to go. You know, it's fucking now they're BFFs.
They all find each other.
Enemy of my enemy, I guess, you know. That's fuck right. Values, you know.
Just, yeah. It's not really about anything except for something else. Mm-hmm. Like they say, oh, it's about Comicsgate values and the customer. No, it isn't. You don't give a shit about the customer. Or like Lone Star 3 would have come out by now. Where's Lone Star 3? Where's the other thing that he was doing?
Or cozying up with Mark Brooks. Like, come on.
What was it, like Monster Hunter or something?
Where's that? Where are all these books? Oh, yeah, what about Comicsgate? What about, you know, this and that and this person's customers? What about your customers, Mike? What about your customers, dude? Any concern for them at all? Like, they don't have their books. And Mike's like, anybody who supports Ethan cannot complain about late books. I'm telling people every day what's the situation is with Rec Planet. I'm telling people every day. I'm showing people Rainbow the Brood stuff. I'm letting them know when they're getting their books. When are they getting your books, Mike?
Is Matt Fowler a war campaigner? He's doing their hashtag. I didn't think he was a war campaigner.
Blame war campaign. Oh my God, Matt, are you war campaign? I didn't know that about Matt. I'll wait.
Learn
for
something new every day, don't we?
Yeah, that's dark, man. Yes, indeed. But anyway, I don't even care. Like, even if you were a war campaign, that's irrelevant. The point is that Mike, his entire problem, his entire issue with Comicsgate, as he told people as recently as 2 months ago, well, they wouldn't kick war campaign out. That's why. That's why I had to leave Comicsgate.
If you can't beat them, join them, Mike.
Yeah.
Send Ro your dick pic.
Matthew Fowler laughs and goes, no. Okay, all right. Yeah, that would have been surprising. Yeah. People want me to scroll away from Brokeback Mountain.
Yeah, I'm kind of...
Well, it's...
Was your gay vampire gene kicking in there, Shane?
I don't know, man. I'm just so happy to see Mike having to redraw his drawing. It just makes me so happy, dude. It's like, if somebody did that to me, like, you pull up my old artwork, you pull up any artwork of mine and just be like, well, this isn't very good. I would just kind of be like, well, next one's better. What are you going to do? Yeah. Not they can't all be winners unless you're Rainy.
30 years later, let me do a draw over and show you what I was trying.
That's an old. Yeah, it's like, don't you see? No, even if you like, it still doesn't work. It's still awful. You're going to blame the anchor like 30 years later. The anchor fucked it up. It would have been perfect.
Just say, yeah. I drew that 30 years ago and I'm basically a new artist. I mean, I don't get the shame in that. Just say it's an old drawing. It sucks.
Look at Irene Strakowski drawing Zombie Sama for Billy Tucci.
Looks good.
Good God darn, man. John, when are you going to let Rini kind of join the club? And when I say the club, I mean, like, you know, the respect. When are you going to give Rini the respect that an artist of her caliber deserves?
Because
you're still, like, you're gatekeeping her a little bit. You're like, I
don't
know. Yeah,
look, I think that, you know, we've got a little bit too much feminine energy in Comicsgate Kings. I think we could turn it back into a boys club.
By kicking Rini and Mandy out?
Yeah. You remember the good old days of Comicsgate Kings?
When it was just without women?
When it was just the guys, you know?
Yeah, people said to me, like, all through the early days of Comicsgate Kings, like, people were like, you know, Rini, there's this woman, Irene Strakowski, she should really be on the show. She's earned it. I said, I don't know how. They said she's, she inked for Marvel. And I said, that's not really, you know what I mean? Like, you do, like, I was under the assumption that's like, she did a couple of inks. Like, she got a couple of gigs at Marvel. But it was really no big deal. No,
I see now, this is a cover?
Yes.
Can I just slap all these people doing covers? Like, Christ, guys, like, Irene, I think is digital. I think she's digital. Slide this motherfucker down about an inch, inch and a half. Give room for the fucking logo. Christ.
I do the same. I make the same mistake all the time. But you know what it is, though? Like, you can do that. You don't have to. Like, here's the thing. What Rini's done is she's made it so that it can be a poster, too, without the logo on it. Like, that can be a poster. Now, anybody who's actually producing this cover, who's actually putting the logo in there, can easily slide it down, lose a little bit of the, an inch or two of the teeth and whatever it is there. What do you think, Shane?
Is that her signature up top? What the fuck is going on?
Actually, John,
everybody got to break the rules?
Hang on, John. The logo's going at the bottom. That's why her signature's at the top.
Oh, is it?
I don't know. I'm just assuming. I don't know. I don't know. Maybe.
Okay, because I could see the logo going at the bottom. I mean, it takes out some of that depth that's being created with that nice foreground image, but I can see it going down there.
Major Chokeout's in the chat. He says, Rini deserves the best. And she's going to get it.
No, he's talking about his dick.
He's talking about his penis. Yurashima Taru says, John gives Irene as much respect as he gives Aaron.
Presti? Oh.
Yeah.
I like how you pretended you didn't know his name.
Well, you know, I mean, there's a lot of people out there in the world named Aaron. Wait, do we have a Comicsgate King called Aaron Lopresti?
Yeah.
Oh,
Wraith of God. So best selling.
Look at all the respect John gives.
I think I'm getting under Aaron's skin, by the way, by calling him old man.
Yeah, oh, really? I saw that. I mean, that would not be cool if he has a heart attack on stream, John. Just let it go.
Wait, wouldn't
be. No, I didn't see any of this. What is this? What's going on?
Oh, I just keep referring to, like, well, a lot. It's not just Aaron, but I think Aaron's the only one taking it personally. I refer to, like, all the professionals, basically, as old men.
Mm-hmm.
Look, it's not untrue. They're all older than I am.
Well, what about Dan Fraga?
Older than me.
Sarkhan DM has his avatar. He wants you to see that he has taken the Rini drawing of a mountain lion eating your dead body and made it his avatar.
Oh, is that what it is? Okay, all right, cool.
Yeah. Let me see here. John has an extremely limited reserve of respect. He has to be stingy with it.
Mm-hmm. Well, you got to earn it, man. You got to earn it.
It's I noticed hard, there were certain professionals that wouldn't come on my stream last night.
Oh, name them. Let's see.
People not
Graham take Nolan, Elm, Graham Nolan, Graham, Dan Fraga,
Art T. Bear.
Fraga barely comes on Comics Gate Kings at all now.
But Shane is always there for these guys. You know what I mean?
Close out. I ate a taco off the floor for Art T. Bear.
Hmm. Hyrule guy said, out. John, you old too. Look, compared to these guys, I'm a child. I'm a babe in the woods.
Well, Shane, I'm always here for you. And that's why I'm here to show your campaign. Even if the other guys won't. I will always say, Inglorious Rex 2. Is awesome. Shane Davis's Inglorious Rex comic book volume 2 is even more awesome. Watch this video and let you tell me.
Not broke.
This sounds like the music I heard last night. It does sound a lot like Top 40. On the scene, I got greatness all in my chains. Ain't no way that I can slow down. I'm laced up, look, I shake the ground. Can't touch the crown, but you can kiss the ring. Close your eyes, see how I live a dream. I'm too smooth, MJ with the lean. Don't be fooled, I can't be with the team. This is over their heads, how high can it go? I'm too over the edge, got my eyes on the goal. And we fight back at it, keep it right on their toes. Look at the way that I move, this is all that I know. Cause I got the drive, I put it in gear. Line them up, I don't see no line them up. If it ain't first place, you really can't settle for it. Listen up, get ready for it. Pride is a sin, everyone. Is it just? Yeah, it is. Pride is a sin. Should not, you know, be over so overburdened with pride that you can't admit that you're drawing a Robin as shit. You know,
just if like, I've drawn shitty Robins before. I'll admit to it. I'm not above it.
You have?
Yeah.
Some of my this dude's drawn a shitty Robin.
Yeah, what a loser.
What a loser.
Like, Robin's like a weird character to draw because he's...
Now you sound like Smiller making excuses. Just say, young, I mean, I was inexperienced.
It's not like a normal superhero body you're drawing. It's like a little...
It's a young man.
No, mm-hmm. It's a teen. It's like you're drawing like a 14-year-old or 13-year-old. It's not a young man. Like, DC Comics purposely wants Robin to be, like, just old enough to drive, but can't.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's the way it was always explained to me. But anyways, guys, please go check out Inglorious Rex. We got 14 days left, $161,000. Let's get to hit that 170 stretch goal. Let's make it happen for Inglorious Rex Volume 2. We got an Irene cover added. We also have a, I almost said Billy Tucci, which we don't. We have a Kenneth Rocafort cover that's added that connects to the previous cover. I'm trying to see what we have for stretch goals.
Opinionated News Guy says, Malin cracks me up, but he's more like a coyote scavenger. Wow. Ooh. Why would you say that?
Like, instead of a wolf, I'm a coyote.
Pete Cowan says, Shane, you drew a shitty dick.
Oh, get it, Dick Grayson. Yeah. No.
No,
Jason Todd. Yanzi, Jason that's Todd. Her favorite.
Yanzi married you because you're Jason Todd.
Yeah, $170,000 exclusive Inglorious Rex Fist logo sticker that we're going to give with every backer. So if you want that cage fist, that's why we're going for 170. I, dude, 14 days. That's like 2 weeks to close this bad boy out.
Shane, don't feel bad that nobody showed up from Brofessionals, though. As soon as they're selling their next book, they'll be there, buddy.
Oh, my God.
You know what I mean? Soon as you're useful to them again.
Dude.
See, I just show up. I just show up. I'm here. I am.
Yeah. Yeah, you know what's weird? You know what's weird, Ethan? I actually had like good views last night. It was like over, like we were almost 800 people at one point in time.
That's because you're a pro.
I don't have like a lot of subs like John. So
now these are Shane Davis's shitty Robin drawings. Right here is one.
Oh yeah, that was when I first got in the industry.
No, that's not bad. That's better really than good. Mike's. That's it's way better than Mike's.
That was like my first job. I wasn't even allowed to draw DC Comics then. I was just doing versus trading cards. If you look at my style back then, you can see I was more cartoony though. Like that's
Yeah, look at his little smile there. He's like tee-hee. Here's another Robin. This looks fine.
Wait, that's what I'm saying. He's hard to draw.
Close in on that. That looks like Shane drew himself as Robin.
What?
Hold on, let me open this in a new tab so we can really take a look at it. You think that's Shane there as Robin?
Yeah, that's young Shane.
Yeah.
What?
An idealized. Something in the chin and the mouth.
Zoom in closer. Jesus, John.
Shane looks at himself in the mirror a lot. I mean, that's the problem. You know, yeah. So he looks himself in the mirror and he ends up drawing himself into everything. Yeah.
I look well, at no, not everything. That he didn't make himself Batman. He made himself Robin.
Cars in Depth says, there was a teen selling ink drawings of comic characters outside a store tonight. So I told him to look up EVS and CG on YouTube and to develop his own IP. Wow. That's great, man.
Dude, the comic industry, we were talking about that last night. This whole payment issue is such a big thing coming unraveled. Now everybody's talking about it.
Can you find more evidence that people are talking about it? Because I can't.
Certain companies like Aftershock had to issue a statement about it.
Aftershock like, did?
Yeah.
Hold on.
Now, who's in Aftershock? Like, that's a relatively newer company, right? Like 10 years, something like
Mike
that.
Mike Martz, who used to...
Oh, yeah, he left Marvel, right, to go...
Yeah.
Do that,
but he's not there anymore. That's the thing, is he left like a while back. So the thing with Aftershock, when they first started up, everybody that was at Image were like, yeah, there's this new company from Silicon Valley that's actually giving us rates, and it's creator owned, but it's like you don't own everything. Like they have options, like they have the rights if a studio picks it up.
Isn't that like the Dark Horse deal?
Kind of
something along the lines of that.
Well, Dark Horse, the deal with Dark Horse is they would be producers. That's why if you ever see, like there's a movie I like on Netflix a lot. It's got the guy from the Hannibal show called Polar.
And Mad Mikkelsen?
I think that's his name. He was the bad guy in Casino Royale.
Yeah, Mads Mikkelsen, I think.
Okay, yeah. I like that guy a lot. The Polar movie's actually fun. It's worth checking out. But that's actually a web comic that then Dark Horse picked up and printed. They never produced it. They just reprinted it. And then if you look at the movie on Netflix, they all of a sudden have their logo and their producers in the movie. Like, that's just something that goes along with Dark Horse still.
Right, but they're getting money for that, right?
Yeah, a lot of people try to work in producer credits and a lot of stuff. I've never really understood like what type of money is behind being a producer. So
it's probably different for every deal. I mean, you have producers, like, executive producers, you know.
Yeah, like if you'll notice, like later in the X-Men stuff, Hugh Jackman was always a producer in the Wolverine films. Like that's just a way for him to get paid more. You know, so it's really weird, the whole producer thing. But anyways,
I would like an honorary credit if they ever made a Graveyard Shift movie or Godlike movie as like the Foley, assistant Foley guy.
But it was Aftershock and Valiant was the other company. And Valiant is evidently late on payment. And they get this, they only produce one comic a month.
Valiant only produces one comic a month. Oh, yeah, I heard about Valiant being
what's being up with Valiant? Yeah, that's all they do is one comic a month, and evidently they're late on paying that bill.
This is ironic. The comic speed is
talking about it,
very ironic, if you know what I mean. Ballsy reports of late payments to creators spread, and one publisher responds. As 2022 draws to a close, there are whispers, statements, and shouts about slowing sales and late payments from various publishers. It's me. I'm the one talking about this. And they all told me I was lying, Shane.
Well, no, actually, you did.
Mark Walter said I'm lying.
No, hang on. You did talk about this, and you're going to find out. Evidently, this has a lot to do with, I forgot to mention that, PPP loans. Remember when the shutdown happened and those things went out? You were saying a lot of the publishing was being propped up by it. I remember this from 2 years ago. I remember you were talking about it.
That's right. Over the last few months, a number of comics creators have taken to social media to discuss late or non-payments. And retailers are increasingly talking about a glut of product, particularly periodical comics. It's not hard to draw a line between these two things. On a podcast with Sketched, David Harper, Bruno Matista of Dublin's Big Bang Comics. Oh, fuck you, dude. Dublin, fuck you. This guy, Big Bang Comics, these people hate on Comicsgate left and right. These people, I don't know what it is with Dublin's Big Bang Comics, but you can take your entire store and shove it up your asshole sideways. Fuck you, Big Bang Comics.
Is that one? I believe there was a company in, like, when we were doing Jawbreakers that was out in, I don't know, maybe I felt like it was like an Irish company, but they were like boycott, one of the first to like boycott us.
Yeah, no, I think that was it. That was Big Bang Comics. Mm. They're always there. Whoever runs this store, whatever, on social media, whoever he is, and it might be Bruno Batista. It might be him. I don't know. Somebody, but he's always chat, like up in our business.
Somebody in the chat asked if me and you were friends before Comicsgate, and I think that's a gay and inappropriate.
Why?
Whoa, man. Now it sounds real gay. What were you guys doing?
Well, what are you talking about? Yeah, of course we were.
We're
better friends now. Like, we were friendly. I don't know if we were friends.
Well, I wouldn't say we were friends.
But we were friendly. Like, I'd be like, hey, Shane, what's up? Like, I'd come over to see you.
Like, and, you know him, you weren't like, hey, what's your name again?
You know, no, I definitely.
I think people would come up to me and think I was Patrick Gleason, and same would happen to him. We would get confused all the time. So I never really knew if Ethan was talking to me or Patrick.
Pat Gleason, yeah. Well, I like both of you guys. So, you know, I still like Pat Gleason too.
Oh, so Shane was kind of like Patrick Bateman in American Psycho, always being mistaken for somebody else.
If I had murdered somebody, if I had murdered somebody at a con, Patrick Gleason would be doing time.
Yeah, it's true.
Hmm.
They really looked a lot alike before. All right. The market cannot take the outpouring of new titles that seem to have no clearly defined audience. I think your boy Zach has been talking about this for a long time. I think your boy Zach, I'm going to credit your boy Zach with this. I feel like it. Yurash Matar says Shane wanted EVS to admit it first that we were friends.
Yeah, we were friendly, not friends, but yeah.
Yeah, I think we're friends now. I mean, I
don't know. People... I don't know if I would trust my back to you or anything. But
God damn. Didn't he just let you host post?
Or no, I'm just being funny.
Didn't he just hand you an audience of, what'd you say, 800 people?
Yeah.
Shane, you could trust me to take care of you. I would. I trust you. I'm cautious about who I personally trust these days for good reason, I think, and who I call friends. But I think you've been there long enough. John Malin is one of the few people who I would actually call a friend. Shane, I think you are in that class too, whether you like it or not. I would definitely do what I could to take care of you and Yanzi.
Yeah, I appreciate it. Thank you.
And Pterodactyl. So there you go. I would. And John Malin. If John Malin was in trouble, I would be there to help John Malin.
I appreciate that. I'm not, but I appreciate that.
No, I'm just saying, like, if you were in jail,
there we go. Real life stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
I like what I do. You. What did I do? Did I kill somebody? Did I strangle?
No, but like, here's women? The thing. Like,
that's okay. Look, there's a difference. If I'm in jail for weed and Ethan bails me out, but Ethan, I'm suspected of strangling four women over a month period. Are you still bailing me out?
Are they? Is one of them Yancey? I mean,
no. Why would one be Yancey? No, we don't know these women.
Oh. Okay, they're complete strangers.
Yeah, women of the streets. Let's say that.
Working girls.
Innocent until proven guilty.
I'd say, you know what I would do?
My pal Ethan coming to pick me up.
Yeah, I would come up to you and I would sit you down and I'd be like, listen, ma'am.
Mm-hmm.
I gotta say I'm extremely disappointed with you.
Wait, I didn't do it. I'm an innocent man.
That's you you're being accused. Oh, then I'd be really disappointed with you. I'd be like, oh, you know, you didn't do this. What the fuck is the matter with you? Get started. I'd be like, four is a good start, John, but
yeah, I thought you would have got away with a lot more before you got caught.
Yeah.
Mm.
All right. So anyway, the Beats Heidi McDonald was also a guest on the episode. Oh, great. That's just fucking assholes. On Mr. Joker 1128 says, Mob Talk, Ethan offers you guys protection. Yes, that's cool. I wish that were true. Talking how freelancer rates haven't increased in more than 20 years. Meanwhile, over the weekend, names were finally named, specifically Aftershock and Valiant, about publishers Ooh. Owing late payments to creators. That's intolerable.
Valiant.
You can't be late with your payments. Although there are several others that creators are talking about privately, and perhaps soon not too privately, or not so privately. You can read the details below, but in a report on the matter, Graphic Policy can go shove their website up their fucking ass, too. I swear to God, it's always the same people.
Now, on these late payments, now, is everybody talking like a period of months behind? Because that's what the other guy was saying, was months with an S.
Yeah. It seems like that. Like, that seems to be the idea. Is like, it's not like a week or two. It's like they're looking at it as like, it sounds like the whole comic is done and they've not been paid.
Our understanding, having talked to numerous individuals within the industry with direct knowledge, is that PPP loans have kept multiple publishers afloat during COVID. And now the publishers haven't adjusted to a new economic reality, and the market isn't where it needs to be, causing money flow issues that are compounded by recent distribution shipping issues and the increased cost of materials and business.
If only we didn't run all those conservative customers off.
Yeah, like, that's weird. What do you mean the market isn't where it needs to be? Isn't the market homosexuals and transgendered people?
Yeah, well, and women? It's not just that. The market, she's been screaming at people, and she'll still do it. I saw her get into it with Donald DeLay, of all people, like a month ago. The market's doing better than ever. Look, YA, manga, these are comics, guys. That's the issue, is you guys have been patting yourself on the back for fucking Japan selling comics to our people. Like, that money never goes back into American comic book publishing. It doesn't go to any American working in comics. It doesn't go to, I mean, maybe the retailer's the only person that's selling manga. That's the only people. And then it's like, now they can get to go, okay, here's the truth. Nobody has money. And you guys she's fucking guilty as fuck. She's been telling everybody on Twitter that the industry, she led that charge. Look at these sales charts. The industry is just quite simply bigger than ever. All these, she calls us charlatans and naysayers, like we're just saying it to sell books. And yeah, I'll fucking talk about a dead dog to sell a book. Why not? But here's the thing. The fucking dog is dead. All right.
Dead dog.
You killed a dog, Shane?
No, I'm saying, like, I'm just reporting.
What are you saying, Shane?
No, I've never killed a dog.
Dogs, you're killing animals. As Shanker also noted, some of the companies being accused of late payments to creators also owe money to comics news websites for advertising, including The Beat. Oh, think of yourself first. Call it the trickle-down economy, and less has been trickling down of late. Aftershock Comics, which has slowed the release of its titles, figured in many of the accusations and released a statement to The Beat regarding the claims. The truth of the matter is that the company is addressing late payments as outstanding funds owed to the company come in. There are no non-payments. Everyone who has owed money will be paid. We recognize our obligations and consider creator compensation our number one priority. We apologize for the situation and are making our best efforts to rectify it as quickly as possible.
Can you? Oh, that's somebody going out of business right there.
Yeah. Don't skip past that. I'm gonna break that down. Like, we'll go ahead and talk about it. But there's something he said that's very irresponsible. But go ahead.
Say, wait, what is it? What are you saying?
Well, why would you mean go ahead? Where am I going?
No, okay, so like comics.
You tell them to stop, then you tell them to go ahead.
No, hang on. Well, just put a pin in it. So if you're a comic publisher and you're dealing in the direct market, you got to advertise the book, right? Like 3 months in advance. So you either have people working on it, or you at least have solicitation and a cover to go in the catalog for retailers to order. Okay, Diamond, most distributors, the money's not turned loose instantly. Like, they have to wait for damages and returns, and that can take anywhere between a month to 6 weeks, or sometimes 2 or 3 months. So it's up to whoever's publishing books and hiring people to print books, or, I mean, whatever, if they're in the publishing market, they have to have, like, a cash reserve of at least 5 months. So he's saying, oh, we're owed money. That's like saying you're in a direct market, dude. You're always owed money.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's just a bullshit statement by a company trying to cover their ass. I'm just calling the bullshit out on that. Like, you're not owed money. You're just waiting on your check from Diamond to pay people. Your problem is you don't have the cash reserves.
Right. That's correct. We prioritize paying our creative people. Well, stop making comics. I mean, if you can't, like, seriously, if you can't pay the creative people, you can't make comics. Just stop it then. Let's go away. And they're talking about a glut of.
IDW is going to be listed as one of these companies looking at their sales and.
Yeah, definitely.
Yeah.
Well, people still invest in them, though.
No, they don't. Their stock market dropped, like, next to a few bucks. Like, you could buy cheap. The other day,
one title a month,
yeah, and they can't pay the bill, John.
Holy shit.
Valiant Comics is also included in the non-payment claims, has also slowed its output to a single title a month at last count. It's the Heather Antos effect. Aside from their monthly newsletter, they haven't sent out a press announcement since August. Everything's great. The outcry against late payments came to a head last week when writer and artist Will Robeson wrote a thread on Twitter bemoaning the length of time it's taken for some publishers to pay their creators. In the thread, Robeson described the typical model for the freelance artist, in which the onus is on them to complete a week's worth of work before even beginning the payment process, and the hardship that's caused when publishers are late. In Robeson's case, 5 to 10 weeks late with payments. He elaborated that the biggest companies in the business are now delaying payments regularly, which has led him to speak out. Among the many responses to Robeson's thread, Joe Chiones tweeted about a pair of publishers who were either currently or extremely late with payments for completed work. Waited recently for over a full year on one publisher before getting paid, Chiones wrote. Currently still awaiting payment, running on 6 months from now from a second prominent publisher, who has largely ghosted me relating to two separate covers I crafted for them last summer. In another tweet, Keone's clarified that second publisher is Valiant, with work in question being covers for Bloodshot and Archer and Armstrong. I would never... Later on... See, that's the problem. You did work for Valiant. Valiant called me and said, do you want to do a cover for Archer and Armstrong? I would just fucking laugh and hang up.
Well, they said that paying their artists and their talent is their number one priority, though, Ethan. You can trust them.
If Valiant called Shane up and asked Shane to do work, do a cover for Bloodshot, Shane would be like, hold on, let me ask my agent. And then he would just fart into the phone as loud as he could, laugh and hang up. Pretty sure that's how Shane would respond.
I had a lot of retailer friends that would order variants from Valiant. I've done a few, but to be honest, Valiant owed me for a script for like a year. And then I called them out on it. Like, they kept switching new heads. And the dude came up to my con. He's like, hey, when are we going to get this one shot going? And I'm like, right in front of people, I'm like, when am I going to get paid for the script that you've had for a year? You know? Yeah. But I actually drew some pages. And he just kind of got really weird. He's like, well, as soon as I get back, I'll make sure you're paid for those pages. It was like 5 pages. I just quit drawing. I was like, dude, you're not going to pay me.
Yeah, you gotta
like,
pay
I'm
people.
Owed a script, I'm owed for 5 pages. I just quit.
Blast Radio says, I do see of conservatives like Edwin, Doug, and Mike types cozying up to and agreeing with far-left SJWs like Mark Brooks against Comicsgate.
Oh, no. I guess they can unify their hate against Ethan.
It's kind of like when Lex Luthor and Brainiac team up.
Yeah, well, we've dubbed them the Legion of Doom at one point, so, you know. Nothing new, right?
Yeah.
Is Doug TenNapel still stirring up things, or has he gone his own way, though? I haven't heard anything about TenNapel in, like, I don't know, a year and a half.
Doug TenNapel, somebody sent me an image of him. He started a new YouTube channel that's like arts and crafts. He's going to teach you to make take a plastic or a paper grocery bag and make the nativity scene.
Hmm.
Yeah. So I support him in that. Like, he's retarded and he should, you know, do retarded arts and crafts for retarded kids.
Yeah.
It's fine.
He'll show you how to cut the gay rainbows out of those garbage bags.
Yeah. He's actually doing the nativity scene, and he's working on, like, you know, the three wise men. He goes, these are my favorite characters in the nativity. Isn't your favorite character supposed to be the baby Jesus?
Jesus, yeah.
I mean, do you have a favorite character in the nativity? Like,
yeah, mine was the donkey in the corner. He's just standing there.
Donkey's doing nothing. Yeah, the baby Jesus should be your favorite, like, if you're a Christian. If you're not a Christian, you can say whatever you want. Like, maybe you like the three wise guys.
Because they had money?
Yeah. Did they ever do the Three Stooges nativity?
Probably because they were Jewish.
Three Stooges meet baby Jesus?
Hey, it's the three wise guys.
Donk. Like, that'd be cool. And
they would pinch his nose. Baby Jesus' little nose would crack.
Well, they would, or they would, like, accidentally step on one end of the manger and Jesus would go flying across the room. Oh, now look what you did.
Yeah.
You know.
That would have been cool. Good. Maybe if it's like some of this CG AI technology, somebody can make that happen.
Yeah, I'm just saying, it's a surprise that they didn't do it, like, you know. But anyway, that's what Doug TenNapel is doing. I wish him well. You know, whatever. Later on, writer Alex DeCampi, writer in quotes, identified Aftershock as another publisher with overdue payments due to its creators. DeCampi quoted Robeson's initial tweet, as well as Alex DeCampi is always there to start shit. Always. Alex DeCampi is like the Smiller of assholes on the internet. As well as another with name redacted, which has been deleted by the original poster. The second quoted tweet described a publisher identified by DeCampi as Aftershock optioning one of the creator's books without telling me or the team at a time and still saying they couldn't pay. Reading the responses to those tweets is an indication of how widespread the problem is. A slowing economy and slowing book sales are surely part of the problem. We're just going to admit that ComicsGate's right.
Yeah, well, that one's really fucked up. You kind of breeze through it. But, like, so the company, which Aftershock, whoever, sold the rights to the comic, like, optioned it, took a check from some Hollywood studio. They probably did it to keep the lights on and never paid the guy for the book. Like, I mean, that's just like robbery at that point. Like, I mean, it's okay. It's not okay not to get paid, but I mean, like, that's like insult to injury. You can't pay him for the comic and then you're selling the fucking rights to the book to Hollywood.
Yeah. Hey, comic book creators, look at a big image of stuff that you'll never see again right here. How much 20s. Money is this? Yeah, a bunch 20, of 20s and not fives.
Not a whole lot. Lots of them.
Yeah. There's a 150.
There's a $10 one up there.
Let's see some $100 bills in there. That'd be nice.
They might not know what one looks like, John. I mean, fuck.
Yeah.
Yeah, here's another image of money. You don't have any of this. If you don't have any of this.
This is how you know that there's a Whisper Network and the whole Shill Media is together. I think Rich Johnson did an article also. Like, all of this is not news and they act like, but then the minute they both break it, it's like, okay. Like,
yeah, now we're allowed.
Together, you guys.
Well, this is the thing. We talked about this. Like, there are some horrendous people in comics that are behaving in ways that are an antithesis to what, you know, SJWs believe or claim to want for comics. And yet they're protected because, you know, nobody has decided. Like, if you came out and said that this so-and-so senior officer at DC Comics was somebody who could not be trusted around freelancers' wives, then, you know, like, that should be an earth-shaking accusation that would really, people would round, you know, got, oh my God, like you would think that that's what would happen, right? But it won't, right, because they, everybody has to decide together. Like these SJWs have to decide together that it's time for somebody to go. And then they'll do that. But if that person is still useful to them in some way, or they don't feel confident in their ability to remove them, they'll just let it keep happening. No, no real standards, no real concerns for women or anything like that, or misbehavior.
The thing I hate about Bleeding Cool is Rich Johnson obviously knows American comics are going down. Like if you look at the site, it is hard to pull any comic news. Either nothing's happening in the books that anybody gives a shit about, mm-hmm, or like he's more interested in talking about like wrestling now and video games and Pokemon. And it's like, dude, you're like the biggest leftist, like SJW type soy boy fucking guy, and your site's reporting on wrestling. Like, dude, they're just going to go to the next thing and try to tear it apart. I'm not even that big into wrestling, but I know they don't need to be there.
You need to be into wrestling because you're doing Peter Payne.
Peter Payne. I'm going through old documentaries.
Okay, that's good. Oh, boo-hoo-hoo. People aren't getting paid. Wah. Wah, wah, wah. I don't care, dude.
I don't like that either. Don't... do the
same.
Say
what cover you want to say. Criticize me.
Do the same cover five times.
Oh, with different colors.
Yeah, it's like,
wait, you know, a minute. This is what I do on Graveyard Ship. It's got a skull, knew that too. It's got a skull.
He laughed
too
evilly.
These guys are ripping me off.
Mm. Wah, wah, wah. Mm. Well, you could just admit that we were right. You could just be like, you know what, Ethan, you're right. Comics are dying. Shane, you're right. Comics are collapsing. John Malin, oh no, what did we do? We called you a Nazi skinhead white supremacist, and you still got all your hair. We must have been wrong.
Damn. Scared Shane.
And then he'll come back. I don't know what he did. I think
I'm waiting for IDW accident to go under, man, because I remember from way back in the day when Tug used to like constantly go through their finances.
Yeah.
Everybody's like, man, their time has to come. Like, I don't know. I feel like IDW is like the Keith Richards of the comic book industry. Everybody's fine until IDW fucking finally goes. Then watch out.
Yeah, IDW has all these investors, though. And I don't know why, but they still get investor money. So, you know, they just keep like losing it. I don't. Is it a front for something? Like, I don't
follow
even know.
The
I'm
money.
Asking questions here,
that's what
but
they say.
Fuck, man. Like, IDW should have been gone a long time ago, and
well,
it's still here.
They were closing down some different divisions of IDW, but it was weird when I was looking into it, like, a year ago, but they were, like, printing, like, fucking maps. Like,
they're printing maps?
And brochures. Like, they had a division of IDW. There was a division of IDW, and they were, like, printing brochures and maps. I mean, when you look at the company as a whole, like, it's a very confusing company. Like, I was like, I thought they just made comics. No, they made different shit.
They got to make something that actually people need. But maps, I don't know if people need maps anymore.
Well, that's why they sold off that part of it.
Yeah, you don't need a map. You don't need a minor attracted person. Mm-hmm. But if you did need one, then you could go to the sci-fi publishing novel, sci-fi novels.
The only thing I've bought from them is their artist editions. I bought some artist editions from them in the last few years. I think the Todd McFarlane one was IDW. And I've heard rumors that there are some that are solicited that people are like, dude, that you may not ever get that one. Like I think they're on life support.
Okay, well, Shane, what about this? A podcast powder keg. Now, I know you haven't heard of this, but I'm going to inform you. Obscura True Crime Podcast, crime podcast, looks to shine a light on the Science Fiction Writers Association's high-profile pedophile members, prompting hysterics online. That's a bad sign. Yeah, when you say, I'm going to look into... Obscura True Crime Podcast is a rising star in the podcasting world, currently holding at 4.6 stars with over 2,600 ratings on Apple Podcasts and over 750 patrons on Patreon. Wow, that's a lot of money. Having sampled a few of their episodes, they seem to offer a mix of free and premium shows that give accounts of the brutal, puzzling, and mysterious brought to life through high-quality audio production that utilizes dramatic effects, news clips, and evidence recordings. Oh, that's cool. True Obscura True Crime Podcast. I'm going to subscribe to this. On Friday, December 9th, host Justin Drown mentioned the following on the show's Twitter feed. I'm considering writing an episode of the Science Fiction Writers Association. Now, this was the association that called, I believe they called John Delarose a racist, and he sued them, I believe, and he won. Some of the names associated with them, with the Science Fiction Writers Association, are convicted child molester Edward E. Kramer, accused child molester Marion Zimmer Bradley, and the deceased card-carrying NAMBLA member Walter Breen. That's fucked up.
Well, thank God he's dead.
Yeah. I'm an avid reader of science fiction. Some of these discoveries have been a disappointment to me, Drown told me via DM. Finding out about Asimov, Isaac Asimov and his son, for example, both creeps. I didn't know that.
I didn't know that either.
But if you check my Goodreads, I was recently dropping 5-star reviews on some of Asimov's work. It wasn't until I started digging into the past of some of the authors that I'm interested in that an alarming pattern formed. Then I started noticing several had ties to the Science Fiction Writers Association.
I wonder if Stephen King has ties to that. Remember that scene in It? It was all pedo. It was like it was a child orgy at the end of It.
Brain Stays Awful says JDA sued Worldcon and the Hugo Awards. Okay, thank you, Brain. Thank you for the correction there. Asimov's grandson has a child pornography conviction. Whoa, dude.
What about Asimov though? What about the guy himself? Is he clean or what?
I think that would be more interesting. Asimov accused of groping female fans.
Oh, who hasn't?
All right.
I mean, been accused, you know, not
been accused. Yeah, exactly. Obscura True Crime Podcast. Almost immediately after the tweet hit, progressive fandom's best and brightest were putting on S-tier displays of histrionics, including a multi-day paroxysm from none other than actual tough guy himself, Patrick S. Tomlinson. Oh, no, Patrick. Uh-oh. He says, you are not owed interviews from the people who you willingly defaming at the behest of criminal stalkers under law enforcement investigation for multiple felony crimes committed against dozens of people over the course of years. The true crime is them. Wasn't that your job? And this guy says, loser who associates with alleged pedophiles and blocks me on and off.
Oh, wow.
I associate with no pedophiles at all. That's called defamation, son.
Well, you said alleged.
Yeah. So you're not willing to answer how you knew a convicted pedophile and for how long? Note that I'm in no way implying that you are one as well. I'm just trying to understand what your relationship with a convicted pedophile was. Was it a working relationship? What part of I'm not willing to be interviewed by a fucking moron taking orders from criminals isn't sinking in with you? Do I seem skittish to you, moron? You're being very directly challenged by the targets of the very cyber-stalking cult whose lies you are amplifying, even while they continue to stalk, harass, dox, and swat their targets. You are aiding and abetting criminals. This guy says, some people seem nervous about my upcoming episode on the SFWA and their relation to child abusers. I wonder why that is. I wonder why they would act this openly skittish. Eric Scott Dubai jumped in to come to Patrick's aid, sort of. And at some point, Paul Weimer locked his account. Wow. And mentioned on Mastodon that he may never be coming back. I have locked down my Twitter account. Given matters deteriorating there, this is Paul Weimer, who's also a...
Was he a writer?
He's a writer, yeah, for the SFWA. He babysitted his neighbor's kid, gave her a bath, and took pictures of her in the bathtub. Published them on the internet.
Damn.
Yeah. And also took pictures of her swinging on the... Why would you take pictures of someone else's child? Why would you give someone else's child, if you're babysitting someone else's child, why do you give her a bath? And then why do you take pictures of her? I don't know. Is that normal?
To send to the parents to show that you're doing something? I don't know.
Yeah. That's what...
Wretched, John.
Oh, I'm taking a guess. I ain't babysitting.
The only reason people know
is these fucking babysitters do.
He uploaded them to the internet. Like, that's the only reason why anybody knows. Like, that's weird. I've seen them.
Why would you have a guy be your babysitter, though?
I don't know. The whole thing is weird. I don't understand these people. But he said, I've locked down my Twitter account, given matters deteriorating there, and given the recent bit with the Obscura True Crime Podcast, and the Oniform Trolls, I may never unlock it again. So he's in permanent hiding.
Wow.
By and large, the announcement seemed to elicit one of two responses. On one side, hand-rubbing enthusiasm. On the other, inexplicable yeah-buddism from people apparently very upset that some of SFWA's dirt was escaping from out from under the rug. Many readers of this site are likely all too familiar with horrific deeds perpetrated by some of the organization's most prominent members and affiliates. The parade of soul-sickening evil committed by the likes of Breen, Bradley, and Kramer. Kramer is the guy who started Dragon Con. And
oh, that guy got arrested, right? That was a big old scandal back in the day.
Yeah. Let's see. It is sadly too voluminous to list here, but an exhaustive five-part report from 2015 titled Safe Spaces, Rape Room, Science Fiction Culture and Childhood's End. This is a Vox Day article. Can be found at Castalia House's website. It's long but detailed, and I highly recommend a look. If you read through that report, one might notice a disturbing dissonance in how SFWA dispenses what it sees as justice. This is typical. This is the comic industry. Vox Day used an SFWA associated Twitter account to racially denigrate a fellow member author. We do that every day, you know. And it was investigated and expelled within 60 days. So Vox was fired for that. The same SFWA with a history of criminally sexual horrors committed by some of its most influential members stretching back 60 years never found time to formally denounce anyone's actions, strip anyone of any titles, or revoke any memberships. Ed Kramer was not only an active member during John Scalzi's presidency. Kramer had been arrested in 2011, tried in 2012, convicted 2013 after being found in a hotel room with a 14-year-old boy. Kramer's membership only ended in 2014 because payment of his membership fees lapsed.
Wow, a search, Jesus.
See, this is crazy, dude. A search of SFWA's website provides precisely zero statements, not even so much as a milquetoast corporate speak press release addressing or condemning the crimes and misdeeds of these individuals. It's a horrible chapter in the history of the institution. I can understand not wanting to put it front and center, but the group came within a hair's breadth of canceling Mercedes Lackey this year for a minor verbal misstep during a panel. We talked about this when it happened. SFWA East their own Mercedes Lackey, who was an SJW and a writer, banned. Why? What did she do? I think she called black people colored people on accident because she's old.
Oh, that's terrible.
Yeah. I mean, this is something else here. Fallout predictably, hold on, there it is.
Wait, Lackey, you can't say colored people anymore?
No. The same day, here's what she said. She's up on a panel. Lackey, who was 72, referred to him as colored, as opposed to the currently acceptable term of person of color. To Grandmaster Samuel Dan. Yeah, he's black.
Racist whore.
So they tried to destroy her over that. These monsters tried to destroy Mercedes Lackey over a minor verbal misstep. These monsters left countless lives, ruined young lives in their wake, with Breen and Kramer seemingly unrepentant upon his release, the house arrest in 2014. Kramer was back to excitedly promoting himself online, apparently without a shred of remorse or self-awareness. What is this shit? What am I going to see here? If I click on this. He's back. Look at him. There he is. There he is. Ed Kramer, co-founder of Dragon Con.
Wow.
What I got a boy in a hotel room. Look at him. There he is now.
What? Oh, is that after someone beat the crap out of him?
I wish, dude. But no, it's just, I need pity. Let me out of jail or whatever it is. And they didn't care, man. Like, nobody cares about this shit. These people just don't care. Too many in the sci-fi community at large strangely seem to all too willing to discuss these past misdeeds simply because they're old or those involved are dead, or to brush it off because it occurred outside of the organization, when these crimes and sins that should be faced unflinchingly. As things stand, accountability seems to have been in short supply, and good leadership should be welcome to open analysis and criticism. The Obscura episode on SFWA. Cannot wait for this! Currently scheduled to upload January 3rd. I can't wait for New Year's. May or may not chronicle anything we didn't already know, but its mere supposition sparked a powder keg on Twitter that's still burning as I type this. Fireworks are going to go off no matter what, and I got my popcorn ready, this guy says.
Hmm.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, I knew about the Dragon Con guy. Like, that's been like kind of like a big open comic book secret. Like, nobody, like, is he still alive?
Yeah. Yeah, I believe so.
Does he, so, he doesn't own the con anymore, right?
No, they finally removed him, but he's being, he makes money from the convention, I believe.
Huh.
Last I heard, he's not there anymore, but he doesn't run it, but he still gets a piece of it, I believe. And that might have ended recently.
I hope they're paying cash and not like some kid at the con. That's all.
Oh, God, Shane. You think they're paying him in underage flesh? What is wrong with you?
I don't know what these people want. These horrible, horrible people. I mean, like, I don't want to say what I'm thinking, but like, I don't know. Being a parent, it's like, fuck me, man.
Yeah, we got to watch out for these people. And that's the whole thing. That is why Comicsgate must stay together and must stay strong, because around us are satanic pedophile vampires everywhere. They're all, I mean, this is, you know, this is where they would hide. They hide where kids are. They hide where they have access to kids. Comic conventions.
Comic industry.
When's the next comic
pedophiles, rapists, racists, true homophobes. These guys are disguised. The wolf, you know, wolves in sheep clothing. We call them SJWs, largely.
Yes.
Do you think it's like they're too busy calling us shit that, like, nobody's looking at anything going on anywhere?
They all have so much dirty laundry. They're all looking after each other, and they all are working on a progressive agenda, which will ultimately open the doors for a conversation for pedophilia, making that common.
In the meantime, yeah, men in comics say no. They have to sign pledges to, you know, to not sexually abuse each other and who even knows what else. I don't know what this is. A lot of ideas.
This is if you're a pedophile, this you should be taking this pledge.
You should. You better be. Yeah, like, you have to. Men in comics say no. There are a lot of ideals we claim to honor in comics. Hope, justice, unity, you're right, innovation, creativity, freedom. None of them mean anything unless men in comics stop fucking kids. Wow. Hold each other accountable for the safety of children and all people, marginalized genders and sexes. What kind of asshole, by the way, what kind of man is sexually harassing a person of a marginalized gender? Like, what is going on there? You know, you got women walking around going, I can't go anywhere without some guy grabbing my dick. Like, what are you talking about? Like, seriously, what do you mean, dude? Is that really a problem? David L says, I'm really enjoying these morning shows. Needs more John and Cecil, less Shane. Wow, that's not nice.
Yeah,
at all.
I saw that. I was like, is he the guy that wrote that Inglourious Rex review with the wet blanket?
Probably.
Shane's still mad at that. That was a glowing review, but Shane is really hung up on the
wet blanket. Well, when you start it, comic by wet blanket, Shane Davis. Like, you know. You know, it sticks.
Oh, yeah. That was a good review.
They're saying, did Jim Lee sign a pledge not to steal more wives? That was a good
question. I don't know. Did I don't know Jim if you signed this. I pledge to never abuse, harass, groom, or manipulate women and all people of marginalized genders and sexes. What are you talking about?
You know again. Every one of these should say again at the end. Like,
no, yeah. That's what I'm saying. There were people that were taking this pledge and retweeting it. And it's like, you fucking idiot. You just said you did it.
It's an admission of guilt. What do you mean people of marginalized genders? So the only question that I want to ask is, do it got nuts? Like, seriously, do it got balls? If it got balls, then it's, you know, we know what gender it is. And it's not marginalized. It's a man. Simple as that. And I will not harass them. Maybe Scott Alley will, if you're Joe Harris. You know, he might bite your ear and grab your nutsack, fondle it while telling you that you're doing good work.
That was gay.
That was very gay, dude. I don't even know, man. What if that happened to you?
So Shane might get aroused.
No, but odd story. I was sitting, he was next to me in Artist Alley, San Diego Comic Con that year, like who? Right beside me, like Joe Harris.
Scott Alley?
Oh, no, Joe Harris. Harris.
Yeah.
And he, I guess it was the morning after that had happened that he was really upset and his whole demeanor was different. I was like, dude, you're right. He's like, I just have to write some stuff that just happened. Like, wow. And he was super serious, and it wasn't until later when that came out, I was like, oh shit. Like, I would have offered him a shoulder to cry on if I had known.
Yeah, if you had known this.
Then I would have been here.
Do you swear, Shane, to hold yourself accountable for your own actions for once? To be open to the comments and concerns of my peers and to educate yourself?
No.
I don't either.
I have no peers.
That's correct. I have zero peers.
Isn't that weird if you're like, hey, you're my peer, and it's like, I'm in comics. I draw indie comics. I draw this like little Cal art style. I'm your peer. It's like, not really.
Ryan Blue Thunder says, for 1,000 Trebek, this person climbed up the hotel balcony like a spider monkey and went into a woman's room naked at a convention. Who is...
That happened, right?
Yes, it did. I'm not going to say his name.
Why not?
But it did happen. Because I don't want to. How do you like that? You know, I'm not narking out my brothers. I'm just kidding.
I almost think that's at least cool. Like, he was doing some King Kong shit.
He needs to go to jail, I guess. I don't know. Why didn't he go to jail? Why didn't he go to jail for that? Isn't that weird?
I don't even know who we're talking about.
It's 3:14 in the a.m. Pi, the hour of pi. All right. Well, just if anybody did that, wouldn't they go to jail?
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. But to actively, Shane, do you promise to actively intervene when we see or know of abuse, harassment, grooming, or manipulation? I personally will actively intervene in all cases of grooming, which is what we've been doing against Disney, and facing opposition.
You know, that one line is actively admitting that you're going to blame somebody else for the shit you do.
Yeah.
Well, the thing on grooming, though, right? Because it used to be related to an adult kind of grooming a child. But, you know, we've learned in the Warren Ellis issue that they've changed the definition. So now grooming can include any two consensual adults, courting each other.
Yeah, you have to have their definition of grooming is that you're in a position of power that they're not at. So grooming,
yeah, and that can mean anything. That could be just for the mere fact that you're a man and she's a woman. You could be grooming anyone.
Yeah.
So, you know, these guys are terrible human beings.
Yeah, Scott Snyder took the pledge. Tom King, a lot of those guys took the pledge. Yeah.
I'm going to ally for women and all people of marginalized genders and sexes experiencing abuse, harassment, grooming. And why don't you just do your comics? I'm going to actively call out our friends and peers, even when no one else is watching. Rich Ware says, do you read California SB 145? Effing nasty. I didn't, but I will in a second. I don't even know what it is. To commit to this pledge for the long haul and to keep this conversation alive in the industry. I love it. Keep it alive. We understand, parenthetically here, we understand marginalized genders and sexes to include but not be limited to non-binary and binary trans people, two-spirit, agender, gender fluid people, as well as intersex people of any gender. Line them up against the wall.
Wait, is that part? Do they have to read that part of the pledge too?
I think so, yeah. Like hashtag comics pledge. You know, this is just ridiculous behavior here to do this.
Yeah.
To have to write this. Men in comics, they know. No, the women in comics are saying no, assholes, because they're all lesbians. When are you going to wake up?
But seriously, like, if you took this pledge, and this is like a license for you to do all this shit, but then just point and blame somebody else. Because you're the guy that took the pledge. Of course, you're the sheriff in town. You're calling this. You're the one calling harassment out.
Like I said, I'm willing to call out grooming wherever I see it. And by grooming, I mean you people in mainstream comics trying to fuck kids. And I will point it out when you support it at Disney, which you have been doing. I'll support it constantly. I will be like, you fuck this. We're all going to call out your grooming. And we shouldn't be banned or consequenced for using the okay groomer hashtag on Twitter. Grooming is a real problem. We need to let people know about it. Okay, groomer, we say to people like that. All right, what is that?
Are we not allowed to call people out for grooming? You lost me there for a minute.
Yeah, they for a while it was a problem. You would get kicked off of Twitter for saying "Okay, groomer."
I didn't know that.
Oh my god, dude! If you only knew. Are you reading the Twitter shit? The Twitter.
So I or not the Twitter the files. Wave. Not the second wave. Yeah.
Hmm.
Senate Bill number 145, California. You know, I'm no genius, but I'm going to take a look at this and try to make heads or tails of it, Shane. Sex offenders registration.
No, shit.
Oh, no. Are they trying to free the sex offenders?
Who knows? That's a lot to read, though.
I'm not reading this. Too long didn't read. I'm sorry this happened to you, or good for you.
Yeah, give us the section number.
You know,
narrow it down.
Yeah, what am I supposed to do? Can't save the world, John.
Mm-mm. Yeah, no, definitely. Why would we even care about California? Let it fall into the ocean.
I've wanted it to for some time.
Mm-hmm.
All right, Jesus effing Christ, says Jay, at Christmas time, which is the wrong time to say that. The wrong time. Let me see. I know a comic shop owner that banged Colleen Duran after she did a signing at his shop. Wow, I wonder if that counts. Jeez.
Whoa. Is Colleen Duran hot?
Yeah, she is. She's very pretty. Ryan Blue Thunder says, private school, Shane, private school. I'll back Rex again just for Terry.
All right. Well, thank you for that. Yeah, I don't know. Private school is probably going to be a thing, or maybe homeschool. I don't know. I always thought homeschool kids were like a little socially awkward, but.
She's got a little nerd to her. I like that.
If her V-neck goes down to her sternum, the pledge is off the table. These are my rules. Understand. That's Brad Frederick who's making that allegation. Don't save the world. Save yourself and your family, says 709. Well, there you go. All I can say to you is this. God bless you all, especially Shane Davis. And if you would be so kind as to back Shane Davis's Inglorious Rex Volume 2,
yes,
that would be great.
It's coming down, I think, the 27th. Is when 27th. It's after Christmas, yeah. So, guys, go check it out. $161,000. We're trying to get this thing to move. We have a Dale Keown exclusive cover in the subscription box, which is a line artwork edition that you get when you back that box. That box will get you everything but the merch. Beautiful Dale Keown artwork. No black boxes on that. And Shane Davis cover, not too shabby. We got a Kenneth Rocafort cover. Irene Strakowski coming in, not leaving room for logos like John likes, you know, but it's still okay.
Mm. I used to say that to the women I was dating. That box will get you everything but the merch, babe. Mm. Worked a couple of times.
Mm.
All right, so back Shane Davis, everyone. Thank you for being with us tonight. John is going to pick up the chat. I don't know, dude. I'm tired now. I'm ready to go to sleep.
Are we doing something this weekend or no?
Yeah, we're doing an auction.
Oh, we are?
Is that official?
Yes, it's official right now. We're doing an auction. I got to promote it.
When is that?
Comicsgate art auction.
But you're closing down Sunday.
Who, me? Oh, yeah.
I'm not your... You don't know all this?
No, maybe I'll do both at the same time. I don't know. Who knows? Yeah.
Not bad. You got a crowd there. You get a crowd, do two things at once.
Yeah. Anyway, that's what we're doing. I invite you all to be here with us, for that exciting moment. Thank you all, for joining us. I will see you again tomorrow with John Malin and Shane Davis and Cecil, probably Anna Rini, some of your favorites. You all have a wonderful evening and a great morning and a terrific day, and try to make someone smile today. What do you say?
Hell.
Anna, it's violence against women. But when you look at it, how do you feel? Seriously, you're okay with it? Be prudish a little bit. Imagine being a customer.
Sometimes women deserve it, so.
That's right.
You made him spit his drink up legit.
Atta girl. That was
You're welcome to whoever.